the capitalizing on Oakland mistakes beat the Raiders with plays like that. But tonight they must play that team, the Minnesota Vikings, led by Tarkenton. Last week, Tarkenton lost to lightly regarded New Orleans because of fumbles like you just saw by Sammy White and a subsequent 97-yard touchdown run by Tommy Myers. So Tarkenton may doubt his team, thus this conversation.
Fran, you came back for this one last year because you wanted to fulfill your dream, winning a Super Bowl. You thought this Viking team could do it. Yet, in their opening game, they were lost to the New Orleans Saints, lightly regarded, a team that was beaten yesterday by Green Bay. Has your dream died? And do the Vikings really have the capability still to go to the Super Bowl?
No, my dream hasn't died at all, but we need to play well tonight against Denver, and we need to win against Denver to get some momentum and get back on the right side of that board. 0-2 is not a good position to be in.
Are you beginning to question your teammates, the quality of this team? Has age overtaken them?
Oh, no, not at all. I think that you'll see tonight that we'll play a very good football game. It's going to be a long year. Different teams play at different levels during the year, and the team that's going to be able to sustain the longest during the middle part of the year, the ones are going to win, and I think we have the strength and the depth to be able to do that.
Final question. Denver is renowned for its defense. You've studied those defenses. Can you pick them apart?
Well, I don't know. We'll see tonight. But, you know, they intercepted Stabler 7 times a year ago in a game. They held Oakland to no touchdowns last year. Our defense has got to keep us in the game, and we've got to move the ball. We feel we can.
Good luck to you, Fran. And so, Monday Night Football, second week. Denver against the Minnesota Vikings. Fran Tarkenton, a key.
20 seconds to air. Stand by, all cameras.
Ready.
Stand by in videotape.
Ready.
Stand by, slow-mo.
Stand by to open your mics on the field.
Stand by in graphics. Ready with your opening sweepers.
Stand by the announcers in the booth, please.
And roll tape. 3, 2, 1. Take tape.
From Metropolitan Stadium in Bloomington, Minnesota, ABC's NFL Monday Night Football. The AFC champion Denver Broncos against the NFC Central Division champion Minnesota Vikings. This ABC Sports exclusive is being brought to you by Buick, currently celebrating its 75th anniversary, and by Buick dealers across the country. Buick, 75 years of cars that reflect the thinking of the times. And by Light Beer, everything you always wanted in a beer and less.
Hello again, everyone. Glad to have you with us for game number 2 of Monday Night Football 1978. This time we think we've got a good one for you. The superb defense of Denver against Tarkenton and the Minnesota offense. But in point of fact, we think the storyline for tonight's game was set by Francis Tarkenton. Yes, indeed, they've grown accustomed to the Vikings' pace around here. They have been winners. But they came a cropper in their opening game, losing to a New Orleans team they thought they had in the pocket. And if they lose tonight, they're 0-2. And as Fran said, that's no position to be in. And if you want to sustain in mid-year, as Fran said, to become the ultimate winner, you can't do it if you lose too many at the beginning. So this early in the season, it's the Vikes who face a crisis, not the Denver Broncos. And the Vikes are not without their problems, regardless of Fran's faith in them. To elaborate on the Vikes, my colleague, Dandy Don Meredith.
Thank you, Howard. You know, my last season with the Cowboys was 1968, and if Carl Eller and Wally Hilgenberg start tonight, it'll be 6 of the same defensive players that started then. So that gives you a clue of where they may be suspect, but the Vikings themselves have not let this go unnoticed. In fact, for the last 4 years, they've drafted 3 defensive linemen and 1 quarterback. Fran Tarkenton is still there. He was also there in 1968, too. I think the idea that the thing we need to find out is that Denver's offense, which has been suspect, will they be able to run, be able to control the ball against the Viking defense? And I know who has that answer, and he is my colleague, Frank, come in here and tell me.
Thank you, Slim.
What
about his diet all day long? And you're not so old. I played against Jim Marshall myself.
That's right.
The Denver Broncos, they are for real. Many people have asked that. They were 12-2 last year, and you're not 12-2 in the National Football League unless you are definitely for real. The suspect part of the Broncos, their offense. But the thing they do not beat themselves. They let other teams beat themselves. They have a great defensive team, and if they can put the offense with it, they truly are going to become one of the great teams. One of the keys is being able to move the ball constantly, and Red Miller has been shuffling his offensive line, trying to get a sustained type of offense. He has a good quarterback, Craig Morton. He's not mobile. If you don't protect him, he's going to get you in trouble. But he is not throwing the interceptions that he used to do. He, of all the leading quarterbacks last year, had the fewest interceptions. In other words, Denver will not beat itself. It's a great football team already because they went to the Super Bowl last year. They want to repeat, and we are looking forward to an outstanding game tonight. The Vikings against the Broncos. We'll be right back.
You're watching television. I'm watching
the Denver Broncos. Hi, I'm Haven Moses. Come with me and discover a special part of Denver. It's called Red Rocks. This magnificent theater was carved out of the earth millions of years ago. You know, I come up here a lot, look at the sky and the mountains, and feel pretty good about living in Colorado. Unfortunately, there are people who cannot see this. They're blind. But the people in Denver help them reach out and touch these mountains through the Red Cross Braille Center. Here, people learn to see with their hands. Blind children enjoy their own special coloring books. Adults read maps and plan trips. These people are an inspiration. They may never see the mountains, but they've got the confidence to conquer them. The Red Cross Braille Center is supported by our United Way. The United Way works in Denver. It works in your town, too. Thanks to you, it works for all of us. United Way.
The preceding announcement was brought to you as a public service of the National Football League. The Minnesota Vikings on your left, 9-5, Central Division winners last year, set to kick off to the Denver Broncos Super Bowl at 12-12 in their season. Mike Wood drills it. This is John Schultz from his 4-yard line. Schultz fells out over the 20 to about the 23-yard line, where Denver will have their first possession. At quarterback, of course, number 7, I just spoke of him, Craig Morton. The two setbacks. Otis Armstrong will start tonight. Rob Lytle has an injured ankle, may not see duty tonight. Otis Armstrong, 24. John Kiewert, the big fullback, number 32. Wide receivers, number 25, Haven Moses. Jack Dolben, 82. He'll see action with Rick Upchurch. Number 80, the tight end is Riley Odoms. First and 10, Denver from their own 22-yard line. The Broncos adjust into a huge setback. Armstrong and Kiewert. Kiewert inside. It's out close to the 25-yard line. Corralled there. Coming up quickly, safety. Number 22, Paul Krause and Matt Blair to make the stop. And there's the defensive line. Some of the names that Don spoke of a moment ago. Make no doubt about it. That's a good linebacking core. Jeff Seaman in the middle. He's tough. Perhaps suspect the secondary. They are weak back there. If somebody should go down in this long season, Minnesota would definitely be in trouble. Second down and 8. The ball just short of the 25-yard line, and we're just underway from Bloomington, Minnesota. Morton, first attempt.
Oh, yeah.
Dumps it off. And moving out to just about the 28-yard line is the big fullback, John Kiewert.
Frank, quickly, we flashed the Broncos' offensive line, which had been suspect when the year started. It is growing better. They moved Claudie Miner, number 71, to the left side at left tackle and brought in Tom Neville, the veteran released, waived, in fact, by New England, to the right side. Neville knows the system because Red Miller taught it to him at New England.
Third and 4, the ball at the 28, Morton again. He goes out to Rick Upchurch, and Upchurch has the first down, and he gets the first down on his first catch. Upchurch, of course, making a bit of a homecoming, played his college football, University of Minnesota. He's out around the 38-yard line. There he is, fourth-round draft pick a few years ago. Howard and I have talked about it before. You can come up on like that in the fourth round. You got a pretty good organization going for you. Averaged over 15 yards every time he's touched the football for Denver.
He's really got them spread out, Frank. I think you'll see a lot of that tonight. Try to stretch that defense as far as it can go, that secondary that you were talking about.
There's the motion man.
Another attempt to screen. Is it a pass or a lateral?
I think it is too.
Advance it by Minnesota's going to get the football.
That's a touchdown.
Yes,
back
sir.
There. Cannot advance the lateral, of course. There's going to be a little bit of debate on this. Happened right in front of the Minnesota bench.
Frank stated the rule very quickly and tersely. You can't advance the lateral. It was the official who misled us, and I'm beginning to believe anything the officials do after Oakland-Denver yesterday. Look at it again.
Well, he got a lot of pressure there from Alan Page, number 88, on a quick screen like that. Somebody's supposed to block him, but that's what Alan Page has been doing for 12 years. He got back to Craig. Craig didn't set deep enough, obviously, and did throw the lateral.
Quick break for the Minnesota Vikings. Just underway. No score if you just join us. The Vikings have a first and 10. They're at the 24-yard line of the Denver Broncos. Out comes Fran Tarkenton. Setbacks. Ricky Young, 34. He caught 12 last week. Chuck Foreman, number 44. Sammy White, 85. Ahmad Rashad, 28. Wide receivers. Bob Tucker starts a tight end. Here comes Foreman. And Foreman slithers inside the 20 to about the 18-yard line. Those are your offensive receivers and your runners. They work behind... Well, if not one of the great offensive lines, a sturdy one, anchored by Ron Yeary on the right, big number 73, on the left, number 78, Steve Riley, both USC tackles and both fine tackles. Yeary, of course, a perennial All-Pro. Vikings, of course, you know about their defense. They're good, very good. They turn the ball over many times for the Broncos, as they did last year. Great linebacking and a fine secondary. It's second down of five. Foreman got five. Motion man Young, this is Foreman. Cutting back and getting to the 15-yard line. Short of the first down, it'll be third and two.
Interesting switch of events with that mistake by Denver that caused the turnover, because historically, as Frank told you, it's Denver that causes the turnovers and capitalizes on it.
One of the things about Craig's low interception has really been the fact that he's been trapped a great deal, and that's kind of a coaching philosophy and I guess a quarterback instinct too, but he doesn't like to release that ball for interceptions. That one he threw too quickly and ran up as a lateral.
Third down, short yardage, Minnesota. Watch 53, Gratishar, 59, Rizzo. They fill like linemen.
Uh-oh.
And it will be short, I do believe.
It'll be awfully close. You got Swenson coming in for that outside linebacker that you're talking about. That's Chavis in there.
Ricky Young looks over. He's short. It's going to be fourth and one. Now, what do you do? Early in the game, 11-17 remaining in the first quarter.
Well, let's ask the quarterback. What do you do, Dunn?
Well, I can tell by the expression on Bud's face he's going to go for it.
You approve?
I certainly do approve. Now, I really think that, you know, you can always go back and say, well, why didn't you? But I do think that it's important to establish that offensive team that, okay, we got to take you on. It's early in the ball game. A lot of things can happen. They've still got a long way to go, even if they don't make it. I would go for it every time.
All right, that's what they're going to do. The three tight ends are in. Stu Boyd comes in, Steve Craig, and Bob Tucker. And keep in mind, Denver led the National Football League last year against the rush, and I'm sure that was going on in the head of Bud Grant. But he keeps this game kind of in perspective. He says it's fun to play.
You know,
he brings his team in late to training camp.
That's true. Tarkenton could do one of his hoop-de-doos here, too.
He's not above it. Setbacks are Robert Miller, 35. Chuck Foreman, 44. Foreman naturally. Did he lunge far enough forward?
This depends on where they mark it.
Denver says no. Tarkenton, of course, says yes. And now,
at the point he put it down, Frank, it would appear that he may have just made it.
Linesman, of course, right at the line of scrimmage, he measures the forward progress. It will be very close. Denver 12-2 last year, knocked off Pittsburgh, knocked off Oakland for the AFC title, lost to Dallas in the Super Bowl. Minnesota beat the Rams, and they lost the NFC Championship to Dallas. Ooh-hoo. Foreman over the top, and I think even his own teammates were surprised. Let's look at it again. Keep in mind, the headlinesman is right on the line of scrimmage.
And it is forward progress. Where that forward progress is stopped, you see that lead in there by Young, and here he comes. Boy, look at that lead. I'm telling you, that is tough defense, too, isn't it? They were all there. Met him head on. A decision by the head linesman, so let's put it down right there.
Ball at the 13-yard line.
action. Tarkenton fires.
Yes, sir.
Tight over the middle. Went to Foreman. Incomplete.
Francis threw it low, but that was a good place because they were around it pretty good.
This Chuckaroo, Frank. It was number 36, Norm Thompson, who thought he had stopped. Hello there. Who thought he had stopped Foreman on the plunge for the first down. The official decided otherwise.
Foreman, I've said it before, and Howard and Don both know, I'd really like to watch him play. He can do it all out there. He's not a specialist.
Did I say Norm Thompson? Bill Thompson.
Bill Thompson.
Maryland State, now Maryland Eastern Shore.
Your first error in 7 years.
There it is.
Tucker. Bob Tucker, the tight end. Short of the first down, getting down to around the 7 yard line, where it'll be third. Well, let's call it third and four.
Boy, do they cover fast. Steve Foley right in there, 43 on the hit. That's the thing about the Denver defense, Frank, as we've commented. They seem to have 22 guys on the field, not 11.
That was Swenson, the linebacker there.
Tarkenton. Right. Into the end zone. Oh. In and out of the hands of Sammy Wyatt, a pass that he could have and probably should have caught. This little man doesn't drop that many.
Well, that was Tark's problem a week ago. That's exactly why at the very beginning of the telecast, we showed you the apparent touchdown pass. Let's look at it from the end zone.
A very familiar pattern. Just we used to call it a down and in. He's trying to get a little help from that. That was a catchable ball, wasn't it? You see him coming to the outside. Nothing fancy. Just trying to get to the inside, get a little rake off right there. Should have been caught.
He'll think about it later tonight. 24-yard field goal attempt. Rick Danmeyer. It's good, and Minnesota has taken a 3-0 lead. They got the big break on a recovered lateral and go in for three. We'll be right back in Bloomington after this message. Standing right at the end zone. This time, short kick, but it'll be Perrin at the 7. And Perrin breaks a couple of tackles and moves out close to the 29-yard line.
Fred McNeil slipped one back there about 10 yards. Fred was down early, but didn't quite hold on.
Don, you talked at the beginning about the age on Minnesota. As we look again at the elder statesman coach, Bud Grant, the importation from Canada. Notably, recognizing that fact, Minnesota has 8 rookies on its roster. Denver has but 5.
Denver, 1st and 10. Look at Craig Morton. Behind him, John Keyworth and Otis Armstrong. Otis, his first attempt of the night, he pops an opening, gets close to a first down up to the 39. And this is the man, I've said it before, that if Denver is going to put the offense with their great defense, if they could get a play back to this man's 1,000-yard year, he had several of them, they have really got something going. He can do it all. He's been troubled with a lot of injuries over the past few years, pulled a hamstring this year in training camp. But he can really explode back in 74. NFL rushing leader, over 1,400 yards. 1st and 10.
Uh-oh.
Minnesota, they might have been drawn off because two Vikings went together. Unless they drew each other off.
You're right.
Walked off against Minnesota.
I thought he pointed the other way.
Encroachment, defense, number 59, first down.
Don Wedge, the referee, gives you the message. We'll look again. They all went together. It would seem that somebody might have just maybe moved a knuckle on that line of scrimmage. Well, that happens once in a while. On 1st down and 5, John Keyworth. And Keyworth takes good yardage. And Denver doing a number on the middle of Minnesota's line. He's close to a first down.
Keyworth, the ball carrier.
When you said earlier Otis Armstrong could do it all, Frank, you're exactly right. I remember a Rocky Mountain Hall of Fame dinner. He had just been drafted. Number one was a rookie. Floyd Little was at the dinner. And Floyd got up and said, I'm glad we drafted Armstrong, but only if he can block. And the first thing he proved was he could block.
Short of the first down, maybe a half a yard.
All
Morton
right.
Didn't like what he saw. Somebody set up in the wrong place. Otis Armstrong, to be exact. Craig took a quick look at the clock. He was running out of time, and he called timeout.
Well, shouldn't make those kind of mistakes.
No, that can cost you later in the half. Timeout on the field, and we'll be returning in just a moment.
everybody to the light beer battle.
In the Super Bowl, 17 years an assistant. He's now in his second year as head coach of the Broncos. Second down, less than a yard. The ball at the 49-yard line. Denver possession. Hank. What's a deep one. And hangs it up and is deflected by, I believe Cross might have got a finger on it. Haven Moses was the intended receiver, and Bobby Bryant was also back there.
They got Nate Wright, too. Let's take another look. He's just a little play action fast. He's got Haven, and he's trying to get him one-on-one, and it is Nate Wright. The ball is pretty well thrown. Let's see if Nate... Yep, Nate Wright stuck that hand in there. Krause was right there close, too. But that ball was pretty well thrown. Good defensive play by Wright.
And meanwhile, back at the line of scrimmage, Greg Morton has left himself third and short. Armstrong following Keyworth, gets the first down over midfield, but a flag is down.
Oh, the big bear, happy birthday. Bear Bryant, head coach in Alabama.
I'm going to happy birthday to Tom Landry. This is Tom Landry's birthday, too. Happy birthday to you, Tom.
All right, we'll say happy birthday then to two great coaches. Carl Eller, who's been in negotiations with the organization and said it's time to play, we'll talk later. He had been placed in a special exempt category temporarily.
Sides against Minnesota accepted, of course, even though they had the first down. They pick up additional yardage. The first and 10 for Denver is inside the 46-yard line of the Minnesota Vikings. The Vikings leading 3-0. John Keyworth wrestled out of bounds.
Nowhere to go.
At the 43, Jeff Seaman moved over there for middle linebacker to make the stop.
It's your Bakersfield boy coming at middle linebacker position, Frank. And he really is. He was drafted number one. Back in 1972, their number one draft choices for Minnesota really have paid off. Foreman came in 73. You got Fred McNeil and Steve Riley at 74. And I mentioned Mark Mullaney, the guy that's filling in for Eller. He came the next year.
Keyworth got three, second down and seven. The ball at the 42-yard line. Martin.
Look out, he draws
a crowd and has to hurry to get rid of it.
Yes, sir.
The attempt to Otis Armstrong, but hustling in there was Mark Mullaney. Look at the top of your screen. Mullaney working against Tom Neville.
They did not pick him up. You can see Neville supposed to either had a mixed up between Neville and the guard. I don't know who did it, but it was, you'll find out in a hurry. But that was Paul Howard and Tom Neville had a mix up when the Vikings did a little switch in there. And nobody got it except Craig, of course, and he picked him up.
Neville, of course, just arrived from New England recently and probably is going to take a little time to set in, but a good experience tackle with 12 years of experience. Third down and seven. Morton fires over the middle, intended for Haven Moses, overthrown and a rather shaky collision downfield. Fourth down. And that will bring on the punting unit. We understand that Joe Rizzo, a linebacker that we have talked about already this evening and a good one for Denver, has left the field. He will have x-rays on a possible fracture in his hand. Buddy Diltz will punt. Kevin Miller is deep for Minnesota. And Bucky angles for the out of bounds. He did it so well last year and he catches a good one.
He sure did.
Down around the 13-yard line. And he did that so well. He was fourth in the league last year. He's done it again. We'll be right back. 7:40 remaining in the first quarter. Frank Gifford along with Howard Cosell, Don Meredith. Oddly enough, a lot of celebrities hanging around. Billy Martin's in the booth earlier. John Denver has flown up to watch his favorite football team, of course, the Broncos. We just watched Bucky Diltz kick one out of bounds at the 8-yard line. First and 10, Minnesota. They lead 3-0. This is Foreman. And Foreman... good yardage out to about the third.
Protect against any kind of a block punt or something like that. He's got about a pretty good start.
Second down, four. Tarkenton gives it to Foreman again. The Broncos stringing out as they do so well. Bob Swenson, who is coming off a shoulder injury, was stringing it out along with Steve Foley.
It was a game where they had a lot of very unusual breaks that went against him. He's got that one up.
Going for Sammy White. Oh. Incomplete. Defending back there, Steve Foley, and the Vikings will have to punt.
Throwing it, and that ball was also very close to being completed. Sammy White was the guy that had a little difficulty in the That ball was right there.
Right
there. Oh, he didn't hit it.
Right,
yeah.
In his hand. This is what's troubling Fran and might make him chary in his use of the pass tonight. Because White failed him last week. Rashad, by his own admission, had a terrible game. You were there when he said, I'll do better this week.
Watch this man, Rick Upchurch. He hasn't run one back in a... Never ran a putback, as a matter of fact, for a touchdown, or rather a kickoff back, and he's had a slow year. The far flag is down. He gets a chance.
No place to go.
Back to the 47. Flag is down. Nate Allen hustling down from the special team. A 39-yard punt by Mike Wood, the rookie.
Looks like illegal motion against Minnesota, I believe, Frank.
And there is the discussion with Haven Moses. Would you like to give Upchurch another chance, or do you want the ball at midfield?
That's pretty good. Pretty good field position right there. Go ahead and take
motion.
It, I think.
The kickers, number 25, declined first down.
The kickers with a no-no. Denver declines it. First down. Just the ball just over their own 48-yard line. Perrin in now, number 33 for Denver.
Oh, they got it.
This is Otis Armstrong. Matt Blair moved in.
He had like a, because I don't know whether it's a blitz or not. I don't know whether he either blitzed or he had that one read so well. They started about the same time, and he met Armstrong behind the line of scrimmage. That Matt Blair made a heck of a defensive move from his linebacker position.
He is quick. Matt Blair on the left side, 59. Fred McNeil on the right, number 54. Seaman in the middle. And Blair gives Denver a two-yard loss. It'll be second down and 12. Morton gets it out on the flat, and it goes to Keyworth, the big fullback. He gets back to the line of scrimmage. That's it. Whether Lonnie Perrin at number 25, Nate Allen is up there to make the stop.
Let's take a quick look, Frank, at the pennant races because of the interest they're in. The Phils leading the Bucks 4-3 in the fifth inning. And Texas, California, zip, zip, and three. Frank?
Third and 13. Upchurch left. Moses right. Morton. Good pocket. Fires it. Right. Haven Moses. Moses has the first down at the 36-yard line. And Craig Morton, so cool. Of course, he really can't move around all that too good anyway, but he had good protection, had the time, and unloaded it.
He really did. This is the third time he's gone to his right trying to hit Haven Moses. Overthrew once. One was knocked down. That time it was wide open. Key again really is, Frank, and always is. Usually the guy had plenty of time to throw. You see him move around. They right into that hole. Actually, there's two receivers fairly close together.
Haven is a steady receiver.
First and 10. Ball at the 36-yard line of Minnesota. Minnesota had 3-0. They had a 24-yard field goal. This is Otis Armstrong. And piled up. Jeff Seaman is there.
I was about to say, Frank, Haven Moses is a deceptively efficient receiver. He's not one of the greatest speedsters in that department in the league. He's not one of the most highly rated players.
Haven Moses, second down and 9. The setbacks are 46. Dave Preston, Lonnie Perrin, 33. Morton wants to go on top again. Watch out. Was his arm in motion?
Yeah. Yeah, well,
yes, it was.
That's just, you got to hit somebody before then. You had plenty of time to throw.
Jim Marshall was in there.
I thought he was holding his hand, Frank, in pain. Let's have a closer look at Craig Morton.
See, that hurts.
All right now.
Watch from the right of your screen. Jim Marshall, the NFL record holder for consecutive games over 251 tonight.
That's I guess you just have to give the secondary credit because, again, there was plenty of time to throw. Marshall was actually pushed out of the way pretty good. The former pocket, Craig stepped up. Big Jim came around and got him on the delayed sack.
Third down, 9. Morton was looking for Moses. Moses well covered.
A fumble.
Buck Sutherland was in there. They popped the ball loose, and there's a mad scramble. And Minnesota has recovered. A Doug Sutherland in there all over Craig Morton. He was waiting for Moses. He was well covered by Nate Wright. And it's number 54 who comes off the bottom of the pile, and that's Fred McNeil. And Minnesota has another turnover.
Right, we'll take another look. You see Southern get cut at the line, gets up, makes his move. He got hit a little bit right there by Mullaney. Came in from the back. Is that Marshall? No, that's Marshall that almost covered the ball, but he didn't. Blair picks it up.
What's interesting here is it's going exactly opposite the way Denver usually goes. They're committing the turnovers. 2-0.
First and 10, the ball at the 38 of Minnesota. Tarkenton quickly on the top. He loves to do it after a turnover.
Look out, Francis.
He'll lose this one. Picked off by number 36, Bill Thompson.
He's down right there.
He was touched and down.
Well, that ball was not particularly well thrown. It was pretty crowded back there, I'd say.
Over the years, the fans get to know the players as well as anybody, including sometimes even the coaches, Dandy, as you look at this again.
Absolutely. Well, he was trying to hit a deep post, Howard, and he just really overthrew the ball. He was trying to hit Rashad coming in there, and we'll be right back.
Bill Thompson gives Denver a turnover. They have the ball at the 34-yard line. He's been some football player, Howard, since back from 69.
Right. He came up, as I said, from Maryland State. Now Maryland Eastern Shaw, the same school that Emerson Boozer came from when Sonny Werblin gave the school a scholarship to get him with the Jets.
His 27th career interception. Martin hands off to Lonnie Perrin. Perrin busts through the line of scrimmage. Nail right there. Surges forward, gets a yard. It'll be second down and 9. Doug Sutherland, the principal Viking, and on the stop along with Randy Holloway, who has come into the game. It's Randy Holloway, 75, Alan Page, 88, Doug Sutherland, 69, and Carl Eller, number 81, is in the game for Minnesota. Ball resting just over the 34-yard line. 3-0, Minnesota. Haven Moses is in motion. Draw play. Lonnie Perrin. And Perrin gets up to the 45-yard line. He has a Bronco first down.
There you go.
I got one of them. We move around too much.
We really do.
Pretty good block on Seaman there. Actually, they moved Sutherland out pretty well, too. Seaman made the wrong turn, came back. Good running by Perrin, actually. Kept his feet. Just pushed right on in. This guy's a busy man, please. Denver Bronco. Kicks off and then receives it, too.
Hey, those two guards in the middle, Glassy and Howard, are doing quite a job against Page and Sutherland. First and 10, the ball at the 45-yard line. Lonnie Perrin again, right side. He pounds out to the 47-yard line, a gain of 3. Tackled by Matt Blair. It'll be second down and 7.
They're an interestingly put-together team. They've used the draft well through the years, the Broncos have. Frank talked about the worth of Otis Armstrong, which is true when he's healthy. But they don't really, except for Rick Upchurch, have a game-breaker on offense. And more often than not, Upchurch is the game-breaker in a specialty capacity as a kick runner. Yet they're so solid on defense, they always hold together.
Second down, 7. Mark it at the 48-yard line. Flag goes down. And Lonnie Perrin pounds forward down to about the 46-yard line.
Again,
Alan Page, I think, tried to get the jump. Or Doug Sutherland right in the middle of the Viking line.
It looked like Doug, Frank.
Good running again by Perrin. He was hit. Offside Viking. Did a lot of that on his own. Yep, he's trying to anticipate a little bit.
Sorry to do that to Doug.
Yeah, that's the way it goes. He had it on film.
That's life.
We're talking about the Broncos.
Brooklyn born, all pro. And Frank and I talked in a preseason game about what a great human being he is.
Dalvin, Upchurch, Moses, all in. One set back, Perrin. Craig firing as a man in the middle.
Oh, yeah. Big hole there. Made a good move into the inside. Ball was well thrown, right on target.
Riley Odoms is the receiver. We're looking upfield. There is a Bronco lying at the 45-yard line. Let's take a quick look at the big tight end. He's a good one. He can get downfield. He has great size and good hands.
Frank, when they drafted him number one a number of years back, there was a lot of feeling around the league that he was the best athlete drafted. Now, Riley Odoms has not become the truly great tight end. He's been a very efficient one. Not in the, of the cut of Casper or Francis. Who is that?
Claudie Miner, I believe. And
right.
He's being attended to there.
All so right. The point I was making about Odoms, though, Frank, is that, like the tight ends of today who are really exceptional, he has the capacity to be a deep threat
as well as to do the blocking job, and as well as to catch the quick one in the seam over the middle.
I think that's really necessary, too, Howard, in an overall offensive situation, to be able to utilize that tight end down the middle and deep. Oftentimes, that same kind of pattern that you saw Denver run, that the tight end will move to the outside to try to draw a safety or a cornerback and let that outside receiver come into the middle. But when you can change their roles up and let that wide receiver come back kind of under the defense and still get that tight end deep down there, it just gives you a lot more problems when you're back in the defensive secondary. I think we can see that Claudia is down. Now let's see what's happening out there in the rest of that field.
He's being looked at very carefully there. He was up against Jim Marshall. Of course, Claudia Minor just last week against Oakland switched over to the left side. He can play both sides. He's a little wobbly, and they are applying a compress over his right eye. We'll get you a full report as quickly as possible. 28-yard pickup, Morton to Odoms. First and 10, Broncos inside the 20-yard line of the Minnesota Vikings. 44 seconds remaining in the first quarter, and the Vikings lead 3-0, a 24-yard field goal by Rick Denmeyer. Preston the setbacks. This is Lonnie Perrin, and Perrin gets back to the line of scrimmage. That's it. He's buried. Sutherland there unpiling, along with number 59, Matt Blair. It's a whole lot of weight on Lonnie Perrin, a third-year man out of Illinois.
It looks that the Vikings have changed up their defensive front four a little bit, and that's Paul Krause we're looking at on the sideline, possibly a muscle pull, but you've got Carl Eller on his familiar defensive left end.
Claudia Minor done. They're working over that damaged eye.
Could have been maybe just maybe a finger in the eye or something like that. I don't know. Maybe it's a harder hit. Yes.
And we'll keep you posted. That's the end of the first quarter. Minnesota over Denver, 3-0. Denver threatening. We'll be right back after this message. Minnesota, however, leads 3-0, and it could just as well have been 14-0. Sammy White dropped a couple of passes he could have, should have caught. Right now, Denver has the ball. Second down and 10. The ball inside the 20-yard line of the Minnesota Vikings. Craig Morton on the option. Lonnie Perrin cuts back and gets down near the 15-yard line, hit there by Tom Hannon. Don't forget, NCAA college football coming your way this Saturday, 1:30 Eastern and Pacific, 12:30 Central, 2:30 Mountain Time. And one of the games you'll be seeing, Penn State against Ohio State. Penn State, of course, is won their first two. It's the opener for Ohio State, but Penn State was not all that impressive. Joe Paterno against Woody Hayes. Regional coverage, Baylor against Georgia. Syracuse versus North Carolina State. San Jose State versus Stanford. Idaho State versus Northern Arizona. And you can consult your local listings for the college game and the time in your area. All of the most of these ABC stations. Third down, 7. Ball just short of the 15-yard line of the Vikings. Martin. Watch Moses. Now he switches off, goes over the middle of the tight end, and I believe that Riley Odoms was hit after he had gone 5 yards downfield. That, of course, the new rule, and we'll keep talking about it because it's going to have a dramatic effect on the scoring and the passing in the NFL this season. It already has. And it's going to go against Denver.
Let me ask a question. Now, if a receiver, you cannot touch the receiver after he goes 5 yards, whether you've hit him once or not.
If you have stationed yourself in a position, it's almost like basketball, and he runs into you, then it's illegal for him.
All right, let's see what happens now. Because, well, now, that's legal, right?
Yeah, there was just a confusion. No, that's not legal. It's been called against Minnesota. The indication was wrong on the field.
Oh.
And it's as we said,
he hit him after 5 yards, Don, and that
makes it
illegal.
The question is, though, if he goes, you can hit him only one time anyway, but you've got to hit him before he goes 5 yards down the field.
That's right. Okay.
And you can hit him continuously. You can hit him continuously if you don't break contact 4 or 5 yards. First down, the ball just resting right at the 10-yard line. Lonnie Perrin, left side. Oh. And he's met there by number 54, Fred McNeil. And he'll lose a yard.
We have pointed out often that the basic defensive strength of this Minnesota team is lodged in their brilliant young linebackers, none of whom has reached the age of 30. Jeff Seaman, McNeil, and Matt Blair. Behind them, another promising youngster who shone well in his rookie year last year, Scott Studley. And then, the ultimate preserve in terms of experience, Wally Hilgenberg.
Bobby Bryant comes in defensively for Minnesota. Second down, 11. Morton, straight drop back. Fires into the end zone, intended there for number 25, Haven Moses. Rick Upchurch were crossing. They were almost together.
Yeah, it looked like he was trying to look them off till the very last minute and turned. I don't think Haven was really open.
Third down, 11. Denver trailing, 3-0.
Oh, there's several people offside.
Wait a minute.
It could have been Bobby Maples.
Yes.
Oh, Bobby.
Induced it.
Bobby, what you do, boy? Wait till I tell Jesse and JD on you. I really think it says when Maples says when he retires, he wants to. Let's see what he's got.
Illegal procedure on number 50. Yeah. False start. Third down.
All right, what's Maples doing up? It's an old trick he learned back in Mount Vernon. What is that?
What is he doing?
Well, I don't know what he's doing. He didn't know what snap was, probably.
Well, he went to turn around Craig and say, what was that number again?
Yeah, when Bobby retires, he wants to get the rights to a telephone booth washing company in Dallas, which is true.
Third down, 16. Denver has the ball. 16-yard line of Minnesota. Craig.
Throw it,
Craig. The crowd fires into the end zone.
He got it.
And picked off by number 25.
How about that? Nate
Allen. Frank, we're seeing all kinds of Bobby Bryant this year. San Diego got a touchdown yesterday on a deflection by Mike Davis of Oakland. We'll be back in a moment.
First and 10, Minnesota. Holding on to their three-point lead. 13-21 remaining in the first half. Chuck Foreman.
Uh-huh. Nowhere to go.
Right to the line of scrimmage.
Friends had five interceptions in five quarters to start this season. He's had a lot of them drop. I think no matter how long you play, there could be a little hesitancy, but I think he is going to have to open up and throw a little bit. And here he
goes. Second down, 10.
There he goes.
Goes out to Foreman. And Foreman. You sum it up. They do have good people in it.
That's one thing.
Third down, 7. Minnesota their own 23.
There he goes.
Tarkenton. Again, dumps it off. This time it's Ricky Young, who set a Minnesota record last week against New Orleans with 12 receptions. In a losing cause, I might point out.
Well, you see Young trying to slip out to the outside and block. The ball has to be thrown quick because he eliminates some of the block.
Rear is a bite.
First acquired from San Diego for Ed White, Minnesota guard. Flag is down, whistles blow, play stopped.
To continue what you're saying, I think what he meant by that is that it does two things.
Washington, straight, drop back.
And there's nobody
wide
there.
Open over the middle.
Yes, sir.
Number 85 is Sammy White. He holds on this time. He had a couple that could have scored on. Well, is he open?
Frank is another example of just hitting that seam. These linebackers drop really fast, really deep. Sammy White came down, turned back around right in between the linebackers. And right in
front of that often. Second down a yard. The ball just short of the 40-yard line. Foreman gets the call to first down. After the 44-yard line.
I think that was a key pass just because they got that penalty. They needed to get back up there. They now picked up a first down. Could have been in a lot of trouble again back in their own end of the field.
And you can see Francis' confidence growing again as he's throwing and then using Chuck then on the ground. Now he can begin. This is the first time they've begun to sustain a drive. And the key to the game, Denver creating the turnovers. They've had three, Minnesota none.
Francis's confidence is not going to really be too started and has to complete those short ones and get something going.
If it's happened, he's seen it.
That's about right.
35 is Robert Miller in a whole bunch of trouble at the line of scrimmage. Swarming Denver defense, and it's such a familiar sight. Denver, of course, in their spanking new uniforms that really are orange, and they, over the years, have been called the Orange Crush, but they were wearing red breeches.
You know what they've done around here tonight to await the arrival of the Bronx? They've put out buttons and purple T-shirts called the Purple Crush.
The Purple Crush. Well, why not?
I think I'd rather drink an orange.
I think I'd rather have grape juice.
Jack Faulkner is given credit for that. He was the one that ordered those jerseys, the uniforms, because he's a Cleveland Brown fan. He wanted to burn orange, and the team back not quite
burnt red.
Yeah,
it is. Second down and 10, Robert Miller, no gain. Tarkenton, quick drop back. Going out to Ahmad Rashad, and Ahmad Rashad holds on, picks up about 4 yards right at midfield. And it's going to be third down and 4.
Steve Foley that came up there. Had them pretty well spread out. There's your Purple Crush shirts.
Hi there.
You know, we were talking about Minnesota's great defense against the rush, but in a 28-team league, they were 25th against the pass. And I know Fran is confident that if he gets the time to throw the ball, he can do it, as other people have done it for him. Third down, a long 4. Tarkenton, quick rolling right. And that's it to Chuck Foreman.
What is it?
He has not got it. It is complete.
Yes,
he's got the first down.
I really can't see over this side field too well.
They could use better lights.
Yep. Well, I don't think you're going to have to chalk this up to running a good pattern unless you want to say after you get
pattern
out there, get open, because that's really what Fran does, and that's what...
Did you see Chuck on that?
Yeah. I noticed when Fran could have easily picked up 5 or 6 yards, and I think a few years ago you have seen him do that quickly.
Oh, go on
and
in a second.
I'll get the next down. He's learned something in 18 years up here, hasn't he?
Get a little wiser. Ball at the 37-yard line of Denver. First and 10, Minnesota. They lead 3-0, and a flag flies.
I don't understand that. That whistle. Well, let's see.
7:30 remaining in the first half. Procedure call against Minnesota at halftime. A special treat coming your way. Muhammad Ali, Leon Spinks. Of course, they'll be fighting Friday night. They'll be talking with Howard live from New Orleans.
Start. Illegal procedure on the offense, number 78. First down.
Steve Riley having a good night. He gets another procedure call. First down, 15. Brent McClanahan, 33, is in the backfield now for Minnesota. Team there with Chuck Foreman. And draw play. Foreman, nice hole, and he moves down to the 35-yard line.
I like that call. I thought that was a good call.
Let's pause 5 seconds and allow our local stations to identify themselves. That's who they are.
All right. Unlike the first and 15 back when they're on the end of the field, they needed to get out of it. Right now, they're moving in a fairly good field position, so instead of going back and throwing that long one on first, he gives it to Foreman, who many of us have seen him take those draws and run an awfully long way with it. At least he picked up about 7 yards. So now it's second and 8.
And Minnesota has rattled off over 6 minutes in this drive. Tarkenton. Lots of time, and he tries to go to Bob Tucker, who had got all tied up with Bob Swenson. And Tucker was not even watching. Of course, he wanted to go downfield, and Denver provided good coverage, and Tarkenton had no deep receiver.
Unlike the Dallas route of Baltimore a week ago, this is, as we expected, a tight and entertaining and vastly interesting game. And it is that because Denver is following its pattern. It wants to stay alive, but tonight it's created the turnovers. Minnesota, on the other hand, with Tarkenton, knows that if it can get 10 or 14 ahead, it may have the game in hand because of the paucity of offense on Denver's part.
Third down, 8. The ball at the 35-yard line of Denver. Tarkenton. And Ahmad Rashad does not hold on downfield.
This is what's troubling Tarkenton. He doesn't understand what's happened to those two men, White and Rashad, who have normally been such superb receivers. Watch this, Don.
Well, it was a good pattern, too. He had Chuck Foreman coming out of the backfield, and right at the last minute, you saw the linebackers go up there. You can't put that one anymore.
Just lost his concentration.
Yeah.
Started to look around, took the eye off the ball. The ball right in the gut fell out.
As we've said many times, they're the ones that hate it most of all. You hate to see anybody drop one like that because they really do take it pretty badly.
There's the rookie punter, an 8th-round draft pick. Hicks is Mike Wood. He will set up, angle for the sidelines.
Offside at Minnesota over there.
Flag is down as you saw the offsides. And Bill Thompson let the ball go into the end zone.
There's a flag on the play.
Friend came back out on the field. He thought it was going to be a...
Well, he was trying to sell the notion.
I guess so. It's a good idea.
Penalty declined. Denver brings the offensive unit out. Of course, they will get the ball on the 20-yard line following the touchback. 6:29 remaining in the first half. Well, they've been going back and forth, but nothing's happening on the scoreboard.
Well, something's happening in Boston because the Birds of Baltimore have tied the Red Sox at 4-4. The Phils, meanwhile, are crushing Pittsburgh 10-3. Phils are close to clinching, but football here, there's the score, we'll be back.
Meanwhile, Denver has a first and 10, the ball at their own yard line. Interesting game. Seesawing back and forth, the score remains 3-0 Minnesota. This is Otis Armstrong. Accelerates out to the 25-yard line, gain of 5, it'll be 2nd and 5. After shattering all kinds of Big Ten records at Purdue back in 73, Otis Armstrong.
It's going to be interesting when we go back to Denver to watch them against, with that great defense, against.
16. Hits over the left side. Alan Page on top there, number 88, and Keyworth. I'll give him a yard. It'll be 3rd down and 4.
It is an interesting stat.
That's the point I was making. This is so unlike Denver. They're the most opportunistic team in football, or have been for the past 2 years.
3rd and 4. Dalvin goes to Craig Morton's right. Haven Moses to his left. And he was running out of time, so he takes timeout. So he had to do that earlier. If you're keeping track, Craig Morton has one timeout remaining. 3rd down and 4, 5:09 remaining in the half when we return.
Headlines, an exciting afternoon of regional games. Check local listings for NCAA football on ABC.
I want to pick up with you later. Frank will call us play on what I was saying, Don. I don't understand why Morton gets caught short as he did so often. 2nd time this game.
3rd down 4. Ball at the 21-yard line of the Broncos.
Just
Armstrong on a 3rd and 4 fooled not a single Viking. They were all there. They all stayed home, and Denver will have to punt. Fred McNeil there first.
I don't think there is any way, Howard, that you can explain a situation like that. It has happened twice tonight, and it's unusual. And I really, it's hard to say it's not called for it, because quarterbacks usually have seen most any kind of defense they can put up there.
I look at Kevin Miller, and you saw Bucky Dilts had a spectacular rookie season last year punting for Denver. And Miller will have his opportunity from the 38.
And he didn't.
And no goal. He tried to get behind the picket line, but Dave Preston was there. 37-yard punt. And Miller lost a few more. About 7 yards, Preston, to be exact.
Kevin Miller on the return.
Bucky Dilts getting a little coaching on the sidelines. And Minnesota will take over first and 10.
A little approbation. Coach was delighted with him. To see his face.
Yeah.
I think he was kicking for him.
How could you tell that it was, he was getting that elevation?
Well, if I tell you,
you
this,
mumbled that.
I know. I didn't hear.
Say it out loud now.
No. Now, what's Bud giving him? He said, don't do that. Go straight.
1st and 10, Minnesota. Tarkenton back. Hangs one. Thank you.
He was trying to get up, I think, and he couldn't.
He's unhappy. There is your ideal cornerback. Sammy White was open, and if Fran would have put it on a string, it might have been a completion. But Louis Wright, with that great 9-6 speed that he had at San Jose State, moved over, picked it off.
Nice play. Boy, if he had, that's beautifully timed, isn't
he
it?
He saved the Oakland game with a play such as that. The two best one-on-one coverage men in this league are Louis Wright and Monty Jackson, now of Oakland. Louis Wright is a super defensive back.
There he is, Bakersfield High School.
Is he really?
He's come a long way. On first and 10. Craig, in a crowd, throws it away. Riley Odoms is in the area, but Craig just had to unload as he was unloaded upon.
Well, they've got Eller back in there. You're going to have... middle of the line, actually, is being challenged. You've got a guys at your center.
Looked at...
See, Seaman. Guys are doing it outside, but
Sutherland and Page.
Yeah, they're doing some work in there.
Otis Armstrong behind good blocking. Squirts through a hole and gets out over the 30. Pickup of 7.
Armstrong, the ball carrier. Seaman and Hannon on the tackle.
Third down and 3. Ball marked at the 31-yard line. Bud Grant came in 67. Won 3 games that year. And
went hunting.
Uh-huh.
From that point on, he's won 9 central divisions out of 11 years. Been to the Super Bowl 4 times.
Found his quarry.
Hunting. Fishing.
Third and 3. Martin had the time, and Eller misses. Loves it over the middle, but it's going to be close to a first down. Larry Canada, who played a major role, as we see backs shuffling, they could be used to bring in the plays. Ordinarily, they use Upchurch and Balvin. Second and 7, screen.
They had that one pretty well covered.
Yeah, Keyworth, yes, to the line of scrimmage. At the 2-minute warning, Craig wondering what we can do to get things happening. They trail 3. A tornado watch was in effect. It all blew by somewhere, and we have a lovely night for football. Temperatures probably somewhere around the mid-70s. 2 minutes remaining in the first half. Frank Gifford, Howard Cosell, Don Meredith. Denver has the football, 3rd down and 7. Ball at their own 38-yard line. Martin draws another crowd. And downfield, Moses could not hold on after Craig did a superb job of being able to get it off.
He really did. He kind of bounced out of that pocket, or was bounced out one way or the other. You see Sutherland coming, Mullaney come in one time. He gets it off just at the last minute. Right, misses it. Moses drops.
Bucky Deltz comes in for Denver. Deep is Kevin Miller. Denver having a tough time there. There's Kevin Miller. They lost Claudy Miner earlier in the game. The center, Brian, had to go out for a while. And Kevin Miller goes down at the 33-yard line, but Denver has not been able to protect Craig. They've not been able to generate any running offense to speak of.
Miller will go back over the sideline this time. He says, all right, now, Coach Bud, I went straight. Look what happened to me. I just ran into a whole bunch of them, and it hurt my head.
That is funny. We got a little lecture for losing 7 yards on the previous punt. This time he took it right straight ahead. First and 10, Minnesota, their own 33-yard line. The motion man is Ricky Young. Looking for a screen.
That was a good move.
Would have been to Bob Tucker, but he had a lot of company.
Oh, Chavis was right out there. Barney had him pretty well wrapped up. He said, wait a minute, he can't do that to me.
Tuck's been having trouble all night. He's been tied up. He can't get off the line, which is great work, a great trick if you can do it. Denver can do anything on.
Minnesota has 3 timeouts.
tentative Foreman was in going for that pass. He had his eye on the linebacker.
Yeah, he's not all dumb either. I thought they could have been. Al Zato had a shot at Fran back there, but I don't think it was. I think it's somebody.
See that on the halftime highlights, the way that game ended.
I've never seen one like it.
Third and 10. Ricky Young in motion. Tarkenton fires over the middle. Ahmad Rashad is there, short of the first down, out to the 37-yard line. Tom Jackson hustling over there to make the stop. 1:20, and the clock is moving.
Davis have been more erring than Craig's, although Moses
tied a couple of NFL records. And back.
Look out.
Five for touchdowns. Oh, and Mike Wood just does get it off. Here's Upchurch.
Well, they're going to get a lot of booing here in Minnesota because that Mike Wood knows how to do that long call.
Right. No call on
him. They did a good job of avoiding him because they were all there.
Now let's see. Well, their foot goes up. I don't believe
what they're booing about, Don.
I think he went right under that leg. I think it was a great call.
5-yard line. They trail 3-0. 35 seconds remaining in the first half. Keyworth, the single setback for Denver.
Martin. Look out.
McCray dumps it off. Keyworth. Keyworth. And he saves the clock.
Look up and see one of your guys running open. And that's just about what happened. He says, oh, my gosh, here's Allen Page again. And whoops, come here, Johnny.
And there comes Eller, and all of a sudden, up pops Keyworth.
Yeah, that's fun.
The ball at the 45-yard line of Minnesota.
Oops, that's low and away.
Dalvin, Upchurch, Moses. Keyworth, the single setback. Riley Odoms, the tight end. Second down and 10. Moses, Dalvin, copy your screen.
George Brenner, Fred Cox, and Jim Turner.
Larry Canada, the single setback. Third down, 10. And Martin, Odoms is open and almost picked off twice. Nate Wright had it in his hands.
Very close on target with Riley Odom cut back in the middle on a pattern that we saw. You see him slow up just a little bit. Good play by him.
Big one interception to tie the all-time NFL record. One fourth down, Denver will go. Flag goes down and Morton goes down at the 45-yard line. Randy Holloway surging it forward. But again, a flag is down. 4 seconds remaining on the clock.
That's the first call Frank's made on Randy Holloway, the number one draft choice of the Vikes from Pittsburgh. He's going to be a brilliant young defensive end. Right now, he is brilliant on the pass rush.
Respectful. And, of course, a live visit with Muhammad Ali, Leon Spinks. Parkinson. Hang it up and hope. In a crowd. Oh, what a crowd. And almost paid off. Rashad almost took the rebound.
They sure are familiar with that hair. They remember Roger Staubach's Hail Mary pass.
Well, you know, this is what do you call one of those things that say we're going to just throw it up there and hope, and maybe somebody's going to get it. I've never seen anybody do that before, but it's a heck of a good idea, I think.
Well, you know, a new rule this year, too. A receiver can deflect it. Right. Another offensive man can catch it. In the past, it would have been an incompletion. But that would have been perfect. Okay. 3-0 in a seesaw battle between Denver and Minnesota. And we'll be back with highlights. Muhammad Ali and Leon Spinks.
That tackle by Dave Butt. And spurts ahead 34 yards. His first of 4 touchdowns of the day. The Eagles lead 7-0. But in the second quarter, with the Redskins leading 14-10, the half almost over. Joe Theismann, the successor to Kilmer, throws to number 84, tight end Gene Fugit. Washington leads 21-10 at halftime. Then in the third quarter, Eagles 4th and 9 from their own 31. The punt by Rick Ingles. Watch closely now. There'll be a new star in the National Football League. Number 34, Tony Green from Florida. Picked on the 6th round by Bobby Bethard. And watch him go. Look at those stats on the day. Tony Green all the way, 80 yards, touchdown, 28-10, Washington. In the fourth quarter. The action beginning to change. First and 10 at the Eagle 37. Theismann handing off to 44 Riggins. Lateral back to Theismann. Flea flicker. Danny Buggs. Touchdown. The Redskins win 35-30. Bart Starr. New Orleans at Green Bay. County Stadium. Milwaukee. And Bart Starr, a beleaguered man. But David Whitehurst seeks to change all that. Here in the second quarter, you saw him throw the flat pass to James Lofton. And look at his stats on the day. Touchdown. New Orleans had been leading 10-7. That made it 14-10 at the half. Then Mr. Whitehurst went to work again with Lofton. Another touchdown. And he made it three touchdown catches on the day as Green Bay won it 28-17. Jets at Buffalo. The Bills trot out on the field. Second quarter, nothing, nothing. Richard Todd looking for a receiver. The pass deflected. Picked off by Buffalo cornerback Charlie Rome at the Buffalo 15-yard line. No problem. Just follow the blocking. Virtually an open field. 85 yards. Touchdown. Buffalo leads 7-0. With that score and 1:09 remaining in the first half, the Jets at the Bills 14. Look at that. Clark and Jones collide for Buffalo. Bauckham takes the ball for a touchdown. It's 7-7 at halftime in the third quarter. Jets 3rd and 19 from the Buffalo 16. And Todd throws to Derek Gaffney, the rookie from Florida. He jaunts in 13 yards. Touchdown. Look at those stats. A teammate a year ago of Tony Green of Washington. The Bills trailed 14-7. But the Bills took a 20-14 lead. Then with 59 seconds left, Todd to Bauckham. And 21-20, the Jets won it. Their second victory in a row. The Bills always tough for them in Buffalo. Raymond Chester, Oakland to your left. To your right, Lydell Mitchell, San Diego. Both former Colts, which should tell you something of the tragedy of Baltimore. Now, second quarter action. Play action. Dan Fouts of San Diego looking toward the end zone. His pass deflected by an Oakland defender, taken in by Pat Curran. Big break. San Diego leads 7-0. San Diego kept that lead. They were leading 20-14 at this point. 59 seconds left. Oakland in desperate position. Stabler back to pass. The dependable veteran, number 40, Pete Banaszak, taking it from their own 32, 14-yard gain to the 46. After that, four straight passes by Stabler completed. And then this on the 14-yard line with 10 seconds left. One fumble, two fumbles, three fumbles. The ball kicked in, and Dave Casper winds up with it. Seven officials they had for this one, and they called it a touchdown. Look again. Was he trying to pass? Did he really fumble the ball? Look at Banaszak. Did he shovel the ball forward? Now look at Casper, kicking it into the end zone, then falling on. San Diego has filed an official protest on this play. Errol Mann converted. Oakland won it 21-20. What a mess.
Confusion yesterday. No confusion right now here at Bloomington, Minnesota. At halftime, the score, Minnesota 3, Denver nothing. ABC's NFL Monday Night Football is being brought to you by Buick, currently celebrating its 75th anniversary, and by Buick dealers across the country. Buick, 75 years of cars that reflect the thinking of the times. Coming up, Muhammad Ali, Leon Spinks, and we'll be ready for the second half kickoff after this word from our local stations.
Between Muhammad Ali and Leon Spinks. Right now, the two fighters are at a reception down in New Orleans. We have the good fortune, as you see them there, to be able to talk with each of them. I spoke with them at length Saturday, but here we go again. Muhammad, quite clearly you're in the best shape you've been in since Manila 3 years ago. Quite clearly you've done everything you can to make that body strong and trim. But the question has to be, after 3 years where you weren't in such good shape, can there still be enough will within you? That's the intangible, and enough strength at your age to beat that younger man.
Are you asking me a question?
Yes.
Yes, it's been difficult naturally to get the body in shape. I'm in shape, and what I will actually do when the real moment comes, I really can't say, but I think I'm in good enough shape to be victorious this time. I'm sure Leon's in good shape, and he believes he'll be victorious. That's what it's all about. See who can win. So I think I can win. I'm sure he thinks he can win. And we'll just wait and see what happens.
All right. You seem to be extremely friendly with Leon Spinks. Is this in point of fact true?
Well, the reason I respect Leon so, the pressure was put on him by Ken Norton and the WBC, World Boxing Council. They even took half his title because he wouldn't fight Ken Norton, who proved not to be a champion because he couldn't defend his title once. He stood up and said, Muhammad Ali gave me a shot at the title, and he deserved another return. And although all the criticism he took from the people and pressing him into taking as part of his title, they did. And he still held fast to give me my chance to fight for it again. And that's why I mind and I don't have nothing bad to say about it.
Leon, you told me last Saturday that there had been some changes in your style. Your style has always natively been to go at the opponent. You talked about bobbing and weaving and perhaps doing some thinking in the ring. Have you thought about that answer since I talked to you Saturday?
Yeah, I have, Justin Howard. I have thought about a lot of things since I talked to you Saturday. And the thing that I talked about, I better keep to myself, because my man's sitting right next to me.
You know that you're younger and stronger than Muhammad. That's what gives you confidence. Isn't that true?
Well, it's just like this, Howard. An older man can do anything a young man can do. It all depends on how he treats his body. All I just know I got to be stronger and come stronger when we get on September 15th.
We began together in Burlington, Vermont at the University of that state. You won the Olympic box off. It was only a couple of years ago. Did you ever dream that you'd be in the position you're in now, the champion defending?
No, Howard, I ain't never dreamed that I'd be in the position that I am now, but nothing stopped me from trying to get here.
Are you going to knock him out?
Howard, the only thing I'm going to do is try to hold on to my gusto while he's trying to get back.
Muhammad, do you have any prediction? Have you changed your mind about predicting?
No, Howard, I'm not predicting. And never can tell what's going to happen. I'm just so glad that he proved to the world the first time that he's a good fighter. It might sound strange, but probably me losing was the best blessing in disguise. All the talk was I'm fighting a nobody with 7 pro fights. You were one of them. Nobody. He's never been over 10 rounds. Barely beat Scott LeDoux. You can't get a bet in Las Vegas. It's a shame Muhammad Ali's fighting the likes of an amateur, a fresh amateur. So he shut all of you up. I'm just glad now you got to recognize him. Now I have a chance to fight for something worthwhile. Now I'm fighting a man that you know is good. He didn't just defeat me. He defeated all the experts. He defeated you. He defeated Las Vegas. He defeated everybody. Now all of you know he's no pushover, and I'm glad he proved it.
Okay, thank you both very much. The noise here has been deafening, but we've done the best we could in trying to hear you. Right now, we're ready for more football. I'll see you both in New Orleans tomorrow. Good
to you both. Over to Frank.
Okay. Muhammad Ali, Leon Spinks, speaking to you live from New Orleans. They fight, of course, Friday night. Here in Bloomington, the Minnesota Vikings lead 3-0 over Denver. They had a 24-yard field goal. From Dan Meyer, and that has been the only scoring. Sammy White dropped a couple that could have given the Minnesota Vikings a 14-0 lead. There you look at the first half statistics, as we've said before, not one of your more glamorous offensive showings, but nevertheless a well-played football game. Denver doing what they have not done before, turning the football over. Both these teams are very opportunistic teams. That's been their history. Denver, more recently, of course, Minnesota. 9 of the last 11 years, they have taken the Central Division, gone to the Super Bowl 4 times, and the man who does it all for them, Francis Tarkenton. He missed 5 games, of course, last year with a broken fibula. And he is back healthy, and if anything, and we've seen him twice this year, maybe a little more conservative, and this is 18th year. Denver will kick off. And that means, of course, Lonnie Perrin. We talked about Jim Turner earlier. He was not a long kicker. Brett McClanahan drops deep for Minnesota. Lonnie Perrin doubles in brass as a setback on the special teams and also does the kicking off. Hope you're enjoying our night, a lovely night here in Bloomington. Our second Monday night game of the season and a great lineup coming your way throughout the year. Teams are set and we're about to get underway. Lonnie Perrin, last minute adjustment to the kicking tee. That's an opportunity to tell you this telecast is presented by authority of the National Football League. It's intended for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast or other use of this telecast without the express written consent of the National Football League is prohibited. Second half underway. Perrin hangs it up. McClanahan from the 4-yard line.
That was Lonnie Perrin that made a tackle over there along with.
He does a little bit of everything.
Yes,
good athlete.
Does.
Lonnie Perrin hustling down to make the stop, and McClanahan gets it out to just short of the 28-yard line. Offensively for Minnesota, Fran Tarkenton, a quarterback, Ricky Young, 34, Chuck Foreman, 44. Those are the setbacks. Wide receivers, 85, Sammy White, Muhammad Ahmad Rashad. One wide receiver, Bob Tucker.
I knew what you're talking about.
Number 38, the tight end.
Don't blame you for that. Keep going.
Ricky Young and goes down, coughs up the ball. I think it was blown dead at the 32-yard line. A gain of 4, it'll be second and 6.
Since you mentioned Muhammad, I've never seen a man more somber, more serious, who has a record of clowning and all the rest. And still, knowing him all the years the way I have, I don't know whether he's putting us on all over again. Whether he really thinks he can take the kid, because he is in shape, take him with ease because of his experience, or whether he's in fact wondering how it's all going to turn out.
Part of his magic. Young in motion. Tarkenton back. Second down. 6.
Nice.
Screen pass.
Nice.
Chuck Foreman.
Oh.
Look at those moves. Oh, he's just Mr. Plastic Man.
That was fun.
First down.
That was Randy Gratisharp and Foley that he left out there on that field. Let's see it again. This was set up really well. They let him come back in. Gratishar actually made him. I won't say Gratishar missed him. He had to jump over somebody to get there. But you like his moves, don't you, Shake?
I do, and Goodrum made a fine block, number 68, coming out.
Not a bad move. Foley tried to get him. He just couldn't quite hold on.
Not a whole lot of folks have those moves. First and 10, 40-yard line. Ricky Young, right side. Squeezes out a yard, yard and a half maybe. It'll be second down, 8. Ricky Young, we talked about as we looked at Craig Morton earlier in the first half. He was a leading receiver for San Diego for the past 3 years and was the leading rusher, and he was a leading receiver last year. So team with Chuck Foreman, Tarkenton really has himself another offensive weapon there. Good receiver and a good runner. Ball at the 42-yard line, second down and 8. Just underway, it's 3-0 Minnesota. Young in motion again. Foreman, he'll have a little bit of running room, and hold. Incomplete, they're ruling. Boy, and I'll tell you, he would have had himself a
lot of
Denver Broncos around him.
But that's the second time he's done it. You notice he was tentative in the reception. Watch him here, looking ahead of him to see what confronted him. See, just as he got the ball, he turned and looked.
He would have had an end zone shot. You would have seen why he might have been tentative. Well, Gratishar coming, Jackson coming, Thompson coming. Take a look at the orange pants working over to the right.
He says, my mama didn't raise no food. Oh, sir.
Third down and 8. Ricky Young, Robert Miller, the setbacks on 3rd and 8.
Oh, he's got him there. There he is.
Miller.
Nice crossing, pattern.
Albert Miller, and he has the first down. He's over midfield, out of bounds at the 49-yard line. Louis Wright picks him out of bounds.
Now you're seeing Francis at his very best as you look at Miller's statistics in his career. Picking them apart, using the short stuff, rolling out. You see Miller come from the left setback
and he's crossing with Ricky Young, who comes in that direction. Very difficult for those linebackers. They try to play man-to-man in there as much as they can. They don't play nearly as much zone as the defensive setbacks. Crossed him up. He had time to throw it. Miller came across.
There's Brash, Bob, and Miller. Darkington, 9 of 20, 69 yards. He threw it 48 times last week against New Orleans. On first and 10, he goes to the air again. Foreman, Chuck Foreman. A little pirouette that maybe wasn't even necessary.
Yeah.
Now, he loves to dump off to his backs. That's been Darkington's history. You said earlier, either you, Frank, or Dunn, that Young had broken the record for receptions a week ago with 12 as an evidence of how he loves to dump off to his backs. Who held the prior record at 11?
Well, it had to be Chuck Foreman.
How about Bill Brown?
Ed Marinaro.
Well, I was close. I was moving in that direction. I knew you were leading me in there somewhere.
Second down, 5. Foreman gets 5.
Chuck Foreman.
Wow. Oh, and is he hit by Jackson?
Oh, Jackson read that one, didn't he, Rick? My gosh, I believe he may be hurt a little bit. He really did come in there hard.
Boy, he took quite a shot.
He really
holding
did.
His shoulder, his left shoulder.
He's a tough one. He has literally been hit 3 times in his life by automobiles, this Jackson.
What?
True. He's out of Cleveland, and he has actually been hit 3 times. I like his hat, man. Right on it. Dance on him. Do it. And we're going to be back in this thing in just a little while.
Saturday, Penn State, Ohio State headlines an exciting afternoon of regional game. Check local listings for NCAA football on ABC.
Tom Jackson is not only good, he's tough. He makes it off the field in his own power. And let's look at the top of your screen now. You'll see Jackson. He got a head right on Foreman's knee. Shook him up. He appears to be okay. He's been replaced, at least temporarily, by number 56, Larry Evans, a third-year man out of Mississippi College, a 14th-round draft pick in 76. Third down and 8. The report is that Jackson just had the wind shaken from him. He should be back. Ball at the 48. Third and 8 for Minnesota. Both backs out of the backfield. Talking a good protection.
Oh, no.
Ricky Young, but the new rule applies as Sammy White makes the reception downfield.
We may set a record for completed deflections this year.
Well, we won't, but we might see it.
He hit him right in the hands, too. I saw him coming back around the linebacker, and I said, oh, he's got Young in there. And that's good. I love that.
Fran having a word with Ricky Young, who did not hold on, but it paid off, as you'll see right here. Young did not hold on to the ball. Sammy White was right where he should have been, and under the new rule, the second offensive receiver or the man who catches the deflected pass to an offensive receiver, it is a completion.
He threw that one pretty hard.
He sure did. First and 10.
He's got a man open down the middle.
And Tarkenton wisely races out of bounds, pays for it dearly, and he dumps it away in the general direction of number 44, Chuck Foreman.
Awfully hard to see those open guys down the middle when you're running in that direction with all those.
Barney Chavis out of
yeah,
after you particularly.
I have a way to have blurred vision in a hurry.
Look at that hot breath on your neck as you turn the corner.
Yes.
Vivid description, Giff.
Oh, Francis. What a guy.
Second and 10. Stuvoid in now, tight end, number 83. Sammy White, 85. Ahmad Rashad, 28. Those are your receivers. Setbacks, Foreman and Young. Jackson's all right. That was Tom Jackson who made sure that Foreman didn't get more than a yard out of it, number 57. So it'll be third down and 9. Some great stats accompany this first round draft pick out of Miami. Maybe already yet. He has in 6 years, or rather 5 years and 2 games, over 7,500 yards of offense. There are a few players in their entire careers in the history of this game that make it over 10,000. He should do it in the Braves. Ricky Young, wide open. Bradishaw. Bradishaw misses, and Young goes out of bounds in the arms of Louis Wright, short of the first down. He had to get to the 24. Makes it to the 28. So it's fourth down. And we'll look for Rick Danmeyer. Here he comes, number 7. He's traveled around a little bit. Right out in Atlanta in 74. Minnesota had him in 75. Went to Chicago. Came back to the Vikings last year. And he is now on with a 46-yard attempt. Has the distance? Yes. All right. So Minnesota extends their lead. And we'll be returning to Birmingham right after this message. Would you believe, with 9:58 remaining in the third quarter, we have no touchdown scored. Two field goals by Danmeyer, Minnesota leading 6-0. Mike Wood will kick off. Boots it high, is taken by Dave Preston. And Preston moves smartly out to the 34-yard line, and the Vikings will try to get it moving again.
Interestingly, Red Miller is staying with Craig Morton. Norris Weiss, the young man from Mississippi, has a lot of movement. He's flashy, and he can be used as a spot quarterback to bring a team to life. The key thing here is Denver, with a touchdown, can take the lead. If they fall more than a touchdown behind on the scoreboard, they're in trouble.
Lonnie Perrin, one set back, Otis Armstrong, and this is Armstrong. And Armstrong, with a couple of nifty moves, gets 5. It'll be second down and 5 at the 38-yard line. There's Danmeyer, hit for 24 yards out for the initial score for Minnesota. And a moment ago from 46 yards out.
Much traveled, as Frank said. Not easy to follow guy there. Good shot. Not easy to follow in the footsteps of Fred Cox. But tonight, he's doing it.
Riley Odom's in motion. Inside handoff. Otis Armstrong right in the arms of Jeff Seaman. Back to the line of scrimmage. That's it.
When you get that motion from the tight end, they're changing the side of their, what they call the strong side offense, which is going to change a lot of their keys back in there. He saw Riley Odom go. He made his move, I think, just really off of a pattern of what they've been doing. Really read it well. They step right up in the middle and away from that block.
Stanford man, academically intelligent, and why not? Trained early at Bakersfield.
Two of them out here tonight from my old high school. The old Drillers, Louis Wright, Denver, and Jeff Seaman for Minnesota. On third and 5, and this is Upchurch. Upchurch has the first down. He's down to the 47-yard line, stopped by Nate Wright. Well, he'll make you a little nervous if you're defending him one-on-one.
Yeah, that's used to be the pattern of Minnesota, as they played a lot of zone, and you would try to read that zone and then go the other way because the cornerback would always drop off pretty deep. Nowadays, they've got so many defenses, it's very hard to read, but that time they were really playing off it in a zone to strong side. Martin, short drop.
And it's picked off. Nate Wright, oh, and he read it beautifully. Nate Wright read that absolutely beautifully. He was down, there's no fumble, and Morton, I don't think he ever saw Nate Wright. He was going for Haven Moses. He took a 3-yard drop, unloaded. Wright, who was probably in his own coverage, stepped right in front of it. That's it.
Yep, you're right.
If Denver, as you look at Nate Wright there, if Denver can hold, stop Minnesota from scoring, here it is coming right at you. Look at that.
Yeah, you saw Wright. You could tell his headgear. He looked right back at Morton. Checked that man on the line of scrimmage first. Checked the quarterback second. Saw Craig Thoe with a quick setup and a quick delivery. Didn't read anybody.
I suspect you'll be seeing Mr. Weiss very early. There is the flashing smile of Mr. Wright.
5-year starter. You don't hear all that much about him, but he does a good job and has for those 5 years. Foreman, single setback. Gets the call on 1st and 10. The flag is down. Barman gets to about the 23-yard line. Barney Tavis over there to make the stop from his defensive end position. But you saw the flag at the top of your screen. Offsides, and it goes against Denver. Denver with a tough schedule start. They open against Oakland. They came out 14-6 there. Next week they play San Diego.
Defense, offside, number 56, first down.
Defensively, it was Larry Evans, the official indicated, who was offsides. But Grant, unhappy. Or is he ever happy?
Oh, he's just implacable.
First and five.
Uh-oh, Ricky Young and Lyle Alzado.
Maybe he got a yard out of it as Lyle Alzado, Randy Gratishar, put the brakes on.
That defense is remarkable. They give you nothing. You've got to find ways. People associate the 30 defense with a number of teams. Miami, New England. Nobody plays it better than Denver. They might have added Oakland, but nobody plays it better than Denver.
Second down, long five. Ball at the 21-yard line. Chuck Foreman over the right side.
Oh, what a move.
What a move. Oh.
What a tackle.
Good open field tackle. Foley. Steve Foley. Hard to get this man down one-on-one.
Made a great acceleration, Frank, right there just by the line of scrimmage. Let's see if we can see what happens. But right here looks pretty well blocked up. That Swenson has got a shot at him, but there, just jumped right across, saw that open space. Good tackle by Foley. That's the way you have to do it, with brilliant individual skills. And Foreman, as we've told you repeatedly through the years, has them. Look at that cutback and that leap.
Yeah, Jackson overran it. He had a pretty good angle on it, overran it, got caught in the pursuit coming the other way. Minnesota with a first down.
Whoops, that'll give me five.
Ricky Young, right side, a late flag, and it does go down.
Oh, boy, that's really costly. You get a first down and 10 down there. You can still make a first down before they score. The guy jumps off sides in the first down. Now he's got first and five from about the 7.
Well, they march it off. We'll allow our local station 5 seconds along the line to let you know who's bringing you this telecast.
Offsides, defense, number 59. First down.
That's a costly one.
There it is, 6-0. We have 6:15 remaining in the third quarter. Parkinson, making sure things get worked out, and they are working out very well. Nate Wright picking off Craig Morton. Good return. Minnesota threatening again. They lead 6-0. Ball at the 8-yard line. Chuck Foreman following Ricky Young.
Oh, what a play.
Gets to the 5-yard line. That's it. Bob Swenson over there, number 51. Going to be second down now. A long three.
Thing is, Frank, that really they've got those, you know, they're gonna go. Well, I'll back out of that one. But I, you know, they've got so many chances to go ahead and pick up that other first down. Theoretically, they can run that thing 8 times in there. And they do need that touchdown.
And they are nipping away at the clock. Ricky Young. Bulls ahead. I don't believe he has the first down.
Key thing, if they succeed on this drive, is what Frank just said. They're nipping away at the clock. And not only succeeding offensively, they're succeeding defensively because Denver can't get the ball. It's an old-fashioned lump drive.
An old-fashioned love song.
Yeah, and if they hang 7 more on that scoreboard, Denver is not noted as one of your strong comeback teams.
No,
not an offensive machine in any stretch of anyone's imagination. And this man knows it. But off to a bad start in New Orleans. They don't want to come out of this game 0-2. Chuck Foreman, right side. And another great defensive effort by Denver. Randy Gratishar sliding along the line with Barney Chavis. And it's going to be fourth down.
Well, you were talking about Norris Weiss a while ago. You're looking at the Minnesota back bench. Let's take a little shot in here and see what's happening. Quick little toss. kind of risky. And here comes Gradishaw in from his linebacker out of Champion, Ohio. Anybody from Champion, Ohio,
boy, is he a football player. They're going to measure, but the kicking unit has already come out for Minnesota. That short, no question what you do.
Ball like 2 yards.
You put it out of a touchdown and a conversion range. So Rick Danmeyer is hit from 24 yards out, and 46 yards out is out on the field.
Penrose and Weiss have been warming up behind the Bronco bench, so I think your anticipation was probably right.
You just can't have enough respect and admiration for that Denver defense. They are really remarkable.
They are tough. Couldn't make 5 yards and 3 shots at it. That's really something.
21-yard field goal attempt, Danmeyer. No problem. And Minnesota hangs another 3 on the board. They lead the Denver Broncos 9-0. 4:26 remaining in the third quarter. Norris Weiss on the sidelines. He appears as if he's coming to the ball game in relief of Craig Morton, who was 9 of 21 for 90 yards and 2 interceptions. Meanwhile, set to kick off, Minnesota. Mike Wood is there. Deep is Lonnie Perrin, flanked by Dave Preston and John Schultz.
Puts
a big foot into this one. And Lonnie Perrin looks it over and says, I'll stay here.
Well, that's a big help when you can get that kicker to knock that thing in the end zone.
There's something I'd like to say for all of us at ABC Sports, and maybe this is as good a time as any as Norris Weiss comes in. Ronnie Peterson, the great Swedish racing driver, died in a crash over the weekend at Monza. We congratulate Mario Andretti on winning the Grand Prix Championship, but share his grief with him over the loss of a good friend and the one man who had a chance to catch him, Ronnie Peterson.
On first and 10 is Norris Weiss in relief of Craig Morton. Comes with the screen pass. This is Otis Armstrong.
Boy.
And Otis tangles up with Fred McNeil, and he wins about a 2-yard battle there for a gain of 6. It'll be 2nd and 4. We'll tell you about Norris Weiss. Rams picked him in 1974. He went to the WFL, played in Hawaii, 74, 75. Came to Denver as a free agent in 76. 2 years, he's had 67 attempts, 35 completions. He basically is a fine athlete. He'll do a lot of running around on you, and he runs well.
He was their leading ground carrier in preseason, I think, Frank.
Option is Keyword. Line of scrimmage, that's it.
They definitely have a different style of offense with the Norris Weiss than they do Craig. But Craig, you can see the plays that they've run, the first 2 plays they've run. Ordinarily, you wouldn't expect Craig to do it.
3rd down and 4. 3 field goals. All Minnesota. 24, 46, and 21. They lead Denver 9-0. And it's Haven Moses. And Moses has the first down at the 44-yard line. Weiss put it on a string.
Yeah.
As we said earlier, Weiss has the capacity to fire up a team.
Looks like he's throwing a dart here. Look at this. Zip, he says. Right in there. Right on the knot. That was nice.
He gives you movement. He's unafraid. Look at him again.
Nice little step right back up in that pocket. And zing.
And credit to Haven Moses. He found the open spot. There's the one shot allowed against him. Hangs in there. He didn't go too far too quickly. 1st and 10 at the 44 for Denver. Otis Armstrong. And Armstrong over midfield. He'll get 8 out of it. Close to the 48-yard line of Minnesota.
Opening them up.
Bill Wise and Tom Hannon.
Sorry, Frank. Opening them up with the pass. He turns to the run. Clever little quarterback. His problem is the ability to sustain. He gives you a lot, and then suddenly he can take it away.
Ball mark just short of the 48-yard line. A quick look at Red Miller. What a great job with this Denver Bronco bunch. Armstrong, another big hole over the left side, and Armstrong has another Denver first down at the 43.
There's a flag down out there somewhere. Earl Curley.
You have to wonder how Craig feels.
I know how he feels.
And it's going to go against Denver.
How does he feel?
Poorly. He feels poorly.
Marched off against Denver. Here's the call.
Holding offense, number 64, second down.
The center, Bill Bryan, guilty of holding for Denver, and that hurts.
Does it?
He had a first down at the 43-yard line of Minnesota. Now they are back with a second down and 13 of the 42-yard line, their own 42-yard line. Armstrong on the draw.
Page almost had him. Good turnaround and picked up about 7 or 8.
Armstrong gets 8 to the 48-yard line. It'll be third down now and 7. And Armstrong leaves the field. In comes Dave Preston, a rookie out of Bowling Green.
Very impressive when we saw him against San Francisco, Frank.
Yes, indeed. He wears number 46. Reese.
Down
he goes.
Didn't Carl Eller got a whack of it?
And then Mullaney finished it.
Yes, sir.
I like that Mullaney. He was one of six who hadn't signed. All of the five of the six have signed. Mullaney has not yet signed, but he has agreed to terms.
That's a Denver guy, too. He makes his home in Denver in the offseason, so he's got a little special.
But that's the youth that they're trying to develop in there that you talked about at the beginning of our telecast. Mullaney and Holloway, two of the Vikes of the future.
And Smith is in there, too.
They've Bucky Dilts.
Bucky didn't get
Hunts
a hold
away,
of
and Sammy White was back, and Dilts loses it off his right foot. So Minnesota is going to have good field position again. When we return, they'll be at their own 33-yard line.
Saturday on ABC's Wide World of Sports, Muhammad Ali, Leon Spinks, action highlights of the WBA World Heavyweight Championship.
And they didn't allow many last year either. Good, tough defensive unit. Just cannot seem to hang the points on the scoreboard. They're playing a good ball club, tough ball club. Perennial winners of their Central Division. And the Vikings leading 9-0 have a first and 10. The ball is at their own 33-yard line. Foreman and Ricky Young, the setbacks. You're watching Ricky Young in motion. This is Foreman. And Foreman out over the 35, close to the 36. Getting a long two. Yep. Second down and 8.
Excuse me, Gip. Don, do you think Fran will play it close to the vest, knowing that Denver doesn't have a smashing or quick-striking offense?
Close to the vest, and that I don't think he'll take any unreasonable chances. I think he'll still throw, but I think he'll try to contain his throwing to the short ones or the ones that he's got something in the open field when he overthrows. I don't think he'll see him make any foolish mistakes.
Ricky Young, and Ricky Young surges ahead out to the 39-yard line, gets 4 more. It'll be 3rd down and 3. Second ticking away as we look at one of the famed Vikings.
It's Don's cousin.
Cousin Willie.
You're watching another exclusive of ABC Sports, and that is the end of the third quarter with the score. Minnesota 9, Denver nothing. We'll return for the fourth quarter and more action in just a moment.
Prevent defense. Don Latimer, the first-round draft pick out of Miami, is in the middle and the nose man in their 3-4 defense. Harkenton dances.
Intercepts it.
Another interception. And attempted lateral bobbled.
Well, that was the thing I didn't think he would do, because that was foolish.
That's exactly why I asked you the question, how did you think Francis was going to play?
Probably the first or second time in my life I've been.
Francis in the pocket.
They really played it well. They saw it coming. He was trying to dump off there.
Gattishar right in front, the intended receiver, Ricky Young.
Yeah, hey,
No. Joe Rizzo. He, the man, of course, who got the three off Kenny Stabler last year. First and 10, Denver. Norris Weiss. Down he goes.
Hello. Fumble.
Off of the ball. Carl Allo really popped him in Minnesota. Has turned it over again.
And then I think he took the ball away from him.
Yes. He will give you something, and then he will take it away.
Weiss is saying, I was down.
He was down, all right.
But he was down without the ball.
Let's check it again. The big Carl just comes sliding around. Whoops. He says, hold on there. That was Riley Odom was trying to block on him out there, and it just a straight knockdown. Look at Riley, number 88. Riley's not... He's just bringing him right back there with him. And I'll tell you, Heller got there, but old Mark Mullaney,
he was, in
was right in there, too. I'd say he was his responsible.
That was 54, fumble. Fred McNeil.
Minnesota now has taken five Denver turnovers. They've given it up three times themselves. Jack Foreman, right side, finds a hole and pounds down close to the 35-yard line. Gain of seven. It'll be second down and three. Tackled there by Randy Gratishar.
There's Carl Eller. Beginning back in the preseason. In fact, when we had Minnesota at Miami, Frank, I walked in on Mike Lynn, the general manager. He was in a meeting with Eller. Eller was seeking to renegotiate his contract. There were difficulties. Eller said, no pay, no play. But then that's been settled. He said, now I'll play and we'll talk pay later. They had placed him temporarily in what they call an exempt category.
Second down and three. Ricky Young, right side, hit there by Bob Swenson. Short of the first down. It'll be third and one.
Foreman had pretty good position on Swenson that time, but it appeared to me that Ricky Young was that half step slow in getting to that hole to make the cut. Swenson.
Using every possible second. The old slowdown offense. They lead 9-0. Foreman.
Ah, boy. I don't know.
Another close one. He tried to hurdle it once again. Tuckenden, little tour director up there for it.
I love that shot of Bud Grant, Frank. He looks still perplexed over the fact that Tuckenden had given the ball away early.
And we'll have a measurement. What a great athlete this man was, Bud Grant. Nine varsity letters.
You played against him, didn't you?
I did. He played some pro basketball for a couple of years. Then he's been up to the Philadelphia Eagles, was second leading receiver. Then he went up to Winnipeg, had a great career up there. As you can see, Minnesota short by that much.
Wasn't he in his 20s when he started coaching up in Winnipeg?
Must have been. He only played 4 years. Started 1956.
He's like 20.
He placed Ali Sherman up there, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, 28, 29 years old. That's right. He ranks fourth on the all-time list of post-coaching victories.
They're going to go for it on fourth down.
They got to. 13, 14 left in the game. They can use up more clock, only inches to make. And they're on the Denver 33, so if they do turn it over, Denver's still got a long, long haul.
Either that or they're going to just let the clock tick down and take a penalty and then punt it. Foreman again, over the top, he's got it.
Yeah, they knocked him back, but I believe they did get it. You're right.
Very similar in the exact spot that we saw the same thing happen in the first quarter.
But they are amazing,
Denver. Denver really is, and I don't blame them. They're all upset. They said, look where he is, man. He's 4 yards behind where he started. But it's that initial point where that forward surge is halted, and then there he is. There's old buddy.
First down, Minnesota. You called a good one, bud.
Dodgers leading San Francisco 3-0 in the third inning, leading by three in the standings. Kansas City a winner, and California a loser to Texas. Royals lead by 1.5. Of course, you know that Boston beat Baltimore 5-4 on two Jim Rice homers. Boston leads the Yankees by a half.
First and 10, Minnesota. Ball at the 32-yard line of Denver. This is Robert Miller. Miller gets a yard and a half for 2 yards. It'll be second down and 8. The ball just inside the 30-yard line of the Broncos. Barney Chavis on the bottom of that pile.
Final baseball postscript gift. Bills crushed the Bucks 10-3. They're ahead of the Bucks now by 5.
3 Dan Meyer field goals. All the scoring we've had tonight. Denver unable to generate any offense. Never even threatening, as a matter of fact. A lot of turnovers. Denver's turned it over 5 times. Minnesota 3 times. Second down and 8. Tarkenton hands off to Robert Miller as Tarkenton trying to grind out the first downs, work on the clock.
And get them at least in a position where it'll take more than a touchdown and a field goal to beat them. They can come away with 3 this time.
That's right.
That's in a good place. So he's
got them in a box.
You bet.
And they've got a hot kicker, Dan Meyer. 24 yards, 21 yards, 46 yards. Third down, 4. Parkinson. He'll be careful. He won't throw it up for grabs. And he's dropped all the way back to the 34-yard line. Good coverage downfield.
Looked like he was trying to. Well, I guess he was just scrambling. But I thought maybe that might have been an initial plug in the play to come back over there to Ricky Young, who was back on that side.
Great shot, Chavis and Alzado.
Did you say that?
Oh, yeah.
I think that reflects the greatness of that Denver defense. A lot of corny stuff thrown around in sports. But if ever a group was together, it's that Denver defense.
They really, truly are.
They're just remarkable, the way they hold together, game in and game out.
Well, they did not get the opportunity for the field goal. Mike Wood is on. Bill Thompson, the safety, is playing up short. But, of course, Mike Wood will go for the out of bounds.
All right,
a block one.
There you go. High snap from center started it.
Alzado, and
always in the seat.
Chavis, always on the spot.
Bernie Jackson in there, Tommy Jackson, they're all together.
They lived by this method of football last year.
That's right. Look at it again.
And a rookie
high snap
from Utah, centering that one. Jim, that ball was kicked low, too.
Lyle Alzado blocks it. Chavis recovers. Watch the top of your screen. Alzado blocks it and then catches the foot right in the face mask. And then his pal, number 79, Chavis, comes up with the recovery. Denver's back in the football game. They have the ball just at midfield, 10-19. Remaining in the game, and the Broncos trail 9-0.
They haven't given up, have they? Look at them.
Let's
get something. Get something.
Norris Weiss is the quarterback. Armstrong pairing the setbacks. Moses in motion.
Oh, they've got 2 men on one. There's a guy wide open by himself. I promise you, there's nobody close to even Moses.
Weiss gets off a pass to Riley Odoms, and that's what Norris Weiss can do for you.
You're right.
That's what I meant by firing up a football team. That's what I meant by having movement. First, it was Page, who had him by the jersey, slipped away. Look at this. There's Page, 88. How he runs right. Then he scampers left, cutting back in the mess, and with arms around him, he finds Odoms.
That's nice.
Three for Weiss. Denver has a first down at the 37-yard line of Minnesota.
And I want to show you, Riley just came out. He was really not in the pattern. It was developed over the other side. You see him when he sees his quarterback trying to react to it. Down the open spot, and there it was. I think there was a defensive mix-up that time before, because they left the guy wide open. They even moved.
Weiss, Lonnie Perrin. And Perrin pecks around until he finds an opening, picks up 4 yards. It'll be second down and 6. Stopped by Matt Blair. Lonnie Perrin, last year, 456 yards. Fifth round draft pick back in 76. Good athlete. As you saw earlier, kicking off, making the tackles on special teams. Denver trying to get back in the game. We're inside 10 minutes. They trail 9-0. Big
big draw, Weiss, and a peck of trouble.
Oh, bounced it.
Yeah, it's out of it. Incomplete.
Tough to do, but you got to be able to do it. You got to be able to throw that ball.
He had Dalvin, too, wide open.
Yes, he did.
It gives excitement, though. Really does.
Eller was giving some excitement to the officials. He felt he had been held that time.
Eller's playing quite a game. He didn't play at all last week against New Orleans.
We used to always try to go inside Eller, around Marshall, and right at Page.
How did it work?
Not too well. Actually, it didn't work too badly.
Rick Upchurch, the speedster, top of your screen. Weiss hits Upchurch. Look out.
There's your guy. There's your guy.
Rick Upchurch down to the 21-yard line. Boy, he's fun.
That's the guy who's a game breaker. And that's what Denver needs in its backfield. Perrin's a good athlete, so is Armstrong. Look at Upchurch again.
Little 5 yard out, a little bit high. There's a good move.
See how far Nate Wright played off him, respecting that speed?
He squirms and wriggles, and he's a great player.
Wriggles?
Wriggles. I wish that I could chimney like my sister.
Wriggles.
First and 10 Denver. They're battling to get back into it. Philly 9-0. Otis Armstrong. Armstrong finds an opening and goes down inside the 15.
This team has come alive with that block punt. Given the opportunity, this is the best sustained offensive drive they've had tonight, and they've gotten the movement from little Norris Weiss.
Seems odd when you say a man's 6'1", he's little. I guess it's all relative.
Stand next to him and tell me he's 6'1", Frank.
Well, if he wants to be 6'1", fine with me. Gain of 8 by Armstrong. Second down, long 2.
Oh, look at Seaman.
This comes again, Armstrong.
Oh, look at that foul. Out of sight.
And Otis is running like he's capable of running tonight.
Seaman had him for maybe even a loss, had a shot at him, couldn't hold on. And Fred McNeil came over, and he actually didn't get a good shot at him either. Let's check Seaman from the middle. Reads the play pretty well all the way, comes out. There's his shot. Slid off the top. We've seen that 2 or 3 times, hit him high. Came on in, and that was Tom Hennon.
First down and goal. Ball inside the 9-yard line. Otis Armstrong.
Oh,
Armstrong both. All the way down close to the 1-yard line. And Denver has put it together, but they put it together too late. Clock ticking away inside 8 minutes. Approaching 7. Let's look again.
They got a good block on Page. You see that Armstrong makes a heck of a move coming back to the inside. They hit that open spot. That line was slightly overshifted to the right side, protecting against Denver coming to the right. Armstrong may have cut back into the middle.
Second and goal. The big man, Keyworth.
Touchdown.
Denver gets rid of the goose egg on the scoreboard.
You asked this, you suggested there may not be time. Frank, the clock shows 6:40 remaining. There is time, as you just looked at a suddenly worried Bud Grant. If they convert now, all they need is a field goal. They won't need a touchdown if they can recapture the football after the kickoff. Plenty of time, in fact. We've got a good ball game tonight, just what we look for, and certainly a crossroads game for the long season to come for the Vikings.
Boy, and you had a chance to see Brett Miller. He was so happy with the performance of Otis Armstrong. Turner,
no. Oh, no. Blocked. I can't believe it.
And that puts an entirely different perspective on this game.
Sure it does. That could give us an overtime game.
We'll try and pick it up.
All right. Oh, I thought he was off. Well, guess not. Big Allen.
Allen Page, slim, trim, and wiry and quick. Allen Page blocks the conversion, and it is now 9-6, the Vikings over the Broncos. Stay with us. Allen Page blocked the conversion. What a difference it made in this football game. Keep your eye on him. Number 88, right in the middle. Usually is Nate Wright.
Or Allen?
Nate Allen, 25.
Hate to say that, but that's right over my old buddy from Mount Vernon, Bobby Maples. He just pushed him right back.
Ready to go. Now Lonnie Perrin will kick off. Deep is Brent McClanahan. Minnesota kind of halfway expecting an onside kick. They don't get it, and Perrin drives McClanahan into the end zone. They have to field that ball. They just can't leave it there. And it's covered by Robert Miller.
This is the touchdown. And you'll see Keyworth just taking it. It's a nice hold. Good blocking on that side. They had Sutherland stood up a little bit. You see, I saw a hand on his jersey pulling him back with him, but those things happen.
Keyworth is a big boy, a 230-pounder. He just bowled his way in there. Tarkenton, 12 of 25, 92 yards. He's had three interceptions. He's had seven on the year already.
Once again, the burden on the Denver defense. Stop Minnesota. Stop them now. Stop them quick. Get the ball back.
Well, if you want a defense with a burden, this is a good one. Chuck Foreman, left side. Foreman, maybe 3 yards. It'll be second down and seven. That's the story. Denver coming to life under Norris Weiss. Moving the football, getting on the scoreboard. The block conversion, of course, set up a potential overtime.
Well, we haven't had one of those in a long time.
Cleveland, New England last year. Cleveland winning it.
See there? It's been a long time.
I knew you'd get that. Second down and six. Chuck Foreman. It's a block from Stilboy. Spins back inside. And that's it. Right back to the line of scrimmage.
Maybe even lost a yard.
Boy, what a defense.
That's that number one draft pick we've been talking about, Don Latimer. He's really quick. He's replaced Reuben Carter in there.
He's bigger and stronger than Reuben. Reuben's been great at the position, but Latimer, as Frank suggested, may be even better.
And Chuck Foreman is down on the field. He was shaken up.
Oh, boy.
Let's just hope that he just has the wind knocked out of him.
All right, a third down and a long seven.
There's a very doleful gentleman in the booth to your right as we look at him, Don.
Yeah.
Mr. Max Winner, the owner of the Vikes. This is a critical game for the Vikes. He knows it. Meanwhile, we'll be back in a moment.
Muhammad Ali battles Leon Spinks for the WBA World Heavyweight Championship live Friday night on ABC.
That's Chuck Foreman with head coach Bud Grant on the sidelines. He walked off in his own power, appeared to just have the wind knocked out of him. Robert Miller has replaced him, number 35. Brent McClanahan's in, number 33. Third down and seven, talking him back and looking. The incomplete. To say it hit the ground before Sammy White came up with it. That'll bring up fourth down, as should give Denver good field position.
All right, they are punting into whatever wind we have here. It's not that much, but there is a little bit of wind.
Well, the Croix de Guerre, the Medal of Honor, everything should go to that Denver defensive unit.
Mike Wood is in, the rookie. You better believe Denver will go for the block. If they don't get it, this man will, Rick Upchurch. They do not go for the block. They go for the picket line. This will be Upchurch. He'll have to go to his right.
And he's got it set up. He's got it set up.
Rick Upchurch, fine return. Gets to the 43-yard line.
Flag down.
Flag down the 35-yard line. Holding, and it's going to go against Denver.
That hurts.
That does hurt.
But maybe only a little. They're the fired-up team now. They've got Don's friend Mo going for him.
Oh, Mo. He is a fickle devil. I'd say we're going to have to take a look at that offensive unit, but also here's the defensive unit. What's he going to say?
Illegal use of hands on the receivers, number 65, during the run back. First down.
Kirk Godwin.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Denver has a first down. The ball at their own 47-yard line. 5:06 remaining in the game. Denver trails by three. Armstrong, Keyworth, the setbacks. Norris Wheat's the quarterback, and he's got this team moving. Tight end is out. Three wide receivers. Weiss going for Moses.
Oh, intercepted.
Picked off.
Was that Paul Krause? Nope.
Looks to me like it's 40, number 49.
Tom. No, it's not either.
Well,
we just won't guess. Tom Hannon, 45, is down.
The second-year man from Michigan State.
Well, that was a nice interception. Threw the ball a long way. He was trying to hit Haven Moses down the middle. Got good protection by that offensive line. And there was that play.
Tom Hannon made a key interception for the Minnesota Vikings, and he crushed to the infield of the Minnesota Twins playing field. And let's take a look at it again. Weiss hung this up awful long, awful high, Don.
Yep. Covered a lot of ground, Hannon did, to come over and get it. I couldn't tell. I thought he fell on the ball, but it appears that...
I think you're right. He fell right on it.
But it might be that right knee, because that right knee was the thing that hit first. I saw him limping a little bit when he came on.
4:58 remaining in the game. Minnesota has the ball. Ball at their own 15-yard line. Ricky Young.
They could sure use a first down, couldn't they?
From their point of view, they could. They're working on his right knee, and I think you were probably right, Don.
Yeah, it looked like when he was up in the air as high as he was, that right knee is the first thing to hit the ground.
Right.
And that's got to hurt. Probably more of a bruise than a twist, but can you imagine what a bruise? Jump that high and come down with your full weight, and that kneecap is the first thing that hits the infield.
Counting down, we're at 4:25, and here's the gift.
Ricky Young got one. It'll be second down, 9. Ball at the 12-yard line. Parkington.
Uh-oh.
In the flat.
Uh-oh.
Ricky Young.
Ricky.
And Ricky Young is held short of the first down. Inside the 25-yard line. He had to get to the 26. It was Steve Foley. Gratishar over there also. Third down, 1.
Oh, is this a biggie? And Denver has shown the ability to contain Minnesota under these conditions a number of times tonight. Look at that stat. That bears out my point. What Denver's going to remember about tonight is, uncharacteristically, 6 turnovers. 3 on fumbles, 3 intercepts.
Fred got a mix-up, didn't he?
He got a mix-up where he didn't like what came in with the 3 tight ends. Walked up to the line of scrimmage, said, no, no, I don't like it. I'm going to go over and visit with Bud. The best chance to tell you about college football coming your way this Saturday. Penn State against Ohio State. Penn State, of course, has won their first 2 games.
Fred got a mix-up, didn't he?
He got a mix-up where he didn't like what came in with the 3 tight ends. Walked up to the line of scrimmage, said, no, no, I don't like it. I'm going to go over and visit with Bud. The best chance to tell you about college football coming your way this Saturday. Penn State against Ohio State. Penn State, of course, has won their first 2 games. It's the opener for Woody Hayes and Ohio State. Joe Paterno always with a good football team. There's regional college football. Also, we have Baylor against Georgia, Syracuse against North Carolina State, San Jose State versus Stanford, Idaho State versus Northern Arizona, and check your local listing for the game and the time in your area over most of these ABC stations.
An openly disconsolate Craig Morton on the sidelines, reverting back to what Frank just told you as you look at talk in the huddle there with Bud Grant and young Tommy Kramer. That Penn State-Ohio State game should be a beauty. It was a year ago, but Joe Paterno, the brilliant coach of the Nittany Lions, has to be a little troubled. They just got by underrated Temple, the margin of a field goal, and they were not that prepossessing, Dandy, in their 26-10 victory over Rutgers.
Maybe not. I think he, Paterno, maybe more than any major college coach, he's won more games without emphasizing that winning is everything attitude than anybody I know at that level. He's got, I think, a nice way with the guys, and from
what I know about him, they all enjoy playing for him. So I might as well get it together and give Woody a heck of a ball game.
And we have a heck of a game going on right here. Tarkenton back out on the field. He gets a new play. Third down, a little more than a yard to go. The setbacks are Foreman, 44, Miller, 35. Tarkenton rolls out. He'll sprint from the sidelines. He has the first down.
That's it.
He gave himself an option. If he could hit a receiver good, if he couldn't, I'll run with it.
Well played defensively, Frank. They had everybody covered. It's pretty difficult, but you only need about a half yard if you ever get on the outside of that tackle, and that's what he did. He held him just for a moment, but look at Gratishaw. He's after him all the way. Didn't prove him for a minute. Swenson may have been held up a little bit there by Stu Boyd, I guess. And he just nipped in there and got him a first down. That was a biggie.
Minnesota has the first down. The clock is stopped at 3:36 remaining in the game. It's 9-6, the Vikings over the Broncos. They should just happen to get home and drop in on us. It was three field goals for the Vikings, and Denver pulled it all together. In the fourth quarter, they got the touchdown, and then they had a block conversion. Robert Miller hops to the outside, but you have a hard time getting away with the quickness of this defensive unit. It looked like it would open for a moment. Nothing happened. He gets three. Ball marked at the 31-yard line. Seconds ticking away towards the three-minute mark. 3:10 and counting. Minnesota with two timeouts. Denver has three. That's what they're battling over. Robert Miller. Miller turns back to the inside, gets a yard and a half. It'll be third down and four. Oh, Rizzo. T. Bronco on that stop.
Rizzo out of Long Island is the one they say is the quiet one. He's the quiet, serious linebacker of that group with the
Merchant Marine
Academy. Right.
Shocked with Buffalo, medical release, supposed to be nothing.
Came in with in a player strike, did he, 1974?
Right. Typical of the way this Denver team has been built. A lot of unknowns.
Third down and four. Heading towards the two-minute warning. Tarkenton back. Oh. He'll take no chances.
I think it could have been a fumble.
He bobbled it, and he got back
got
on
back.
It.
I saw a loose ball there.
And it'll be fourth down, and Denver will have an opportunity.
Uh-oh.
Lyle Alzado is down, holding a left knee.
Oh, no. Is that the one that was operated, do you know?
I don't know. I know he did have surgery.
Doesn't? Oh, I hate to see it.
As great as that defense is, you can't lose the fulcrum of it. Yep. He is.
Let's see what happens here. He was trying to get back in. He gets some pretty good pressure. Look at there. There's old Chavis, who came in on a circle move, and he had him wrapped up, ran right into Lousada. Looked like he maybe got both of their body weights thrown in against him there.
He's up.
He's all right. Tough cut.
Good, good.
He is quite a man, too. He is.
See him nod his head, Frank. I'm okay.
They presented him an award this past year as the man of the year for multiple sclerosis drive in Colorado. Active all kinds of community affairs.
How about when he came east to join us in that affair we had at the Felt Forum at the Garden?
That's the one I was speaking of. That's the one I was speaking of. He is really a remarkable man. Denver kills the time so they can take advantage of the stop at the two-minute mark. And boy, he could put some fury in you. Rick Upchurch.
Well, he's the key guy. If he can somehow kick run them back into field goal position, we could go to overtime.
What a year he had in 76. Remember Howard? Four TDs in 76.
He was
tied two NFL marks. And returned two for touchdowns in one game and four for the year.
Stage is set for him. Here it is. Back in his home
check territory. Out his dramatics.
Yes, sir.
He's pacing, too.
Well, you know they're going to have a shot at it because you could, as we've all said many times, do an awful lot in those last 2 minutes, but they are going to get fairly good field position even if he has to call for a fair catch. They won't be more than, I'd say, 60, 65 yards away from the goal.
Interesting thing, as Frank mentioned, he was drafted in the fourth round. Having gone to Minnesota, they knew about him around here, but they thought he might be too small and too brittle. Quite the converse.
Mike Wood, the rookie. Set to punt for Minnesota.
Oh, an all-out rush. Means Rick Upchurch will be doing it on his own.
Well, he's doing it.
Oh, he's doing it.
Look at that man go.
Rick Upchurch to the 43-yard line.
And they've got time. 152.
Steve Craig made the stop. You know, he's a little man. He only weighs 170 pounds. But he runs like a 220-pounder with that great speed. So Denver is in good field position. They trail by three. They have a first and 10 on Minnesota's 43-yard line. We'll be right back. It's been a night of turnovers here in Bloomington, Minnesota, and we come down to 152 remaining on the clock. That's the story. Minnesota leading Denver 9-6. Denver has the offensive momentum at the moment. They have a first and 10 at Minnesota's 43-yard line. This man, Norris Weiss, ignited the spark when he came in relief of Craig Morton, third-year man out of Mississippi. Hasn't played all that much. Little action last year. On first down, through the air, incomplete. Intended for Upchurch. Nate Wright was defending the ball, however, just under throw.
Remember now, they want to get in reasonably close because their field goal kicker, Jim Turner, is almost uncannily accurate, but doesn't have the big foot to give it a long kick. So they got to pick up about 20 yards.
Does have a little wind behind him tonight.
And you're right about the distance, Howard, but he stretched one out there last year, 48 yards.
In Denver.
Mm-hmm. With the altitude. Country.
That's right.
Second down and 10. Weiss. Man open and he overthrows Riley Odoms. And he had him open. And he knows it.
Yes, you can see him and he knows it.
And Odoms took a tough fall as he went for that ball. He's leaving the game. Egloff is coming in. Let's look again. He had worked himself into the clear. Matt Blair trying to stay with him.
He had that step, though, didn't he?
No question. He had position. Good throw. Just a decent throw. And they would have had the field position they wanted for the field goal.
Egloff is in. Weiss in trouble. It fires it over the middle.
Now there's a flag down anyway.
Flag is down. If it's a dual possession, it goes to the offensive man. Nate Wright was in there battling with Rick Upchurch. But a flag is down.
I'm not surprised that they... I don't know what the heck they're doing. Walk it off, all right.
1:36 on the clock. We're going to get this worked out in a moment.
Illegal chuck. Defense, number 43, first down.
Nate Wright got into Upchurch after Upchurch had gone 5 yards downfield. Now, you can't even touch this man. Of course, he can't run into you.
I guess that would be holding.
How about a chucking hold?
Well, I don't know.
First and 10.
That's the break Denver needed.
Ball at the 38-yard line. Weiss again. And down he goes. A whole bunch of Vikings led by Mullaney.
They put it on him that time, didn't they?
James White was in there. You know, I'm not so sure about the call. Otis Armstrong was running the ball so well. They had plenty of time on the clock. They need 3 points to get themselves even.
You're exactly right.
And he's throwing the ball every play.
What you can't do, because they've got 3 timeouts left, is panic and fall prey to the pass on every play.
Second down now and 14. The ball at the 41-yard line. Moses out to the right. The setbacks are Otis Armstrong, 24, Keeler, 32. Has to go to the air this time. Goes to the tight end. That's Egloff.
That's him.
He's got the first down.
And they are there. I said 3 timeouts. Correction, they've got 2 timeouts. But they are there.
They've got position now for Turner.
So Denver calls timeout. That's the clock. And let's look again. Egloff, who replaced the injured Riley Odoms, second-year man out of Wisconsin, worked himself into the clear. He comes really up with the first down. We're going to measure, but I'm sure it's academic.
Well, he did get pretty wide open there. Seaman is trying to go back and drop. It looks to me that maybe one of the linebackers had his back turned differently.
This kid's good.
Yeah.
Don, we saw him against San Francisco, and he gave us a well of a game. Ron Egloff
came up as a free agent. Worked his way onto the team on the special units. We saw Odoms go down a short while ago, and now Egloff, potentially a Denver Bronco hero tonight. 55 seconds on the clock, and they're getting close to Jim Turner's range. They are in range already.
That's right. You know, maybe we've overemphasized Turner as a shorter but accurate kicker, because once he did kick one 53 yards. However, Jim's been around a lot of years. He was unerring with the Jets Super Bowl team in the days when he was wearing those high shoes. Now he's turned to the low white shoes. Says it hasn't affected his kicking at all. Actually, at his age, makes his foot feel more limber, lighter.
Interesting to see how they play this. Denver has one timeout. They have 55 seconds on the clock. They keep the ball in play. They're going to be very careful, of course, but if they keep it in play, they've probably got to save that first down to stop the clock to get the kicking team on the field. All right. On first and 10.
Oh, he's gone. Oh, what happened?
Got hit just as he unloaded and incomplete. A dangerous effort by this young man. And he's been shaken up. I think he's going off.
I was looking downfield. Right. I didn't see it, so let's see it again here on the air.
Watch Jeff Seaman, number 50. Jeff Seaman.
Uh-oh. And that hurt Weiss's knee, but he pulled himself together. He started as if he were going to leave the field, and he came back into the huddle. 51 seconds remaining. Second and 10. Clock, of course, stopped with the incompletion. Armstrong and Keyworth, the setbacks. Armstrong. Upended, but he gets closer to a Jim Turner toe. Down to the 22-yard line. Five-yard pickup. It'll be third and 5.
That play really looked good coming around that corner there. I thought that would might pick up more than it did, but you're right, 5 yards closer.
And they're going with the hurry-up offense. They want to save that one timeout. Third down, 5. Clock ticking away. 25 seconds.
He's got some room. Whoops. He got it.
He got him. It's Egloff. Egloff at the 6-yard line, and I believe Weiss would have run, but he is limping noticeably. Feeling better now. That's it. Final timeout. 16 seconds on the clock. That was Haven Moses on the reception.
I'll tell you, that little fella showed us a lot tonight. Horace Weiss, gutsy guy. Remember the background. Drafted originally by L.A. Went into the upstart league.
He got then, three guys rushing there, and that line is doing a heck of a job.
Yeah, tough little man, too. He'd shaken up a moment ago. I think he would have run, and Haven Moses found the open spot. Saw that 5. Quite frankly, there's some dark lights down there.
You bet. Well, you know, it's just a same old story. When you break that pattern, the timing goes, then it's kind of anybody's ball game. And the advantage really is to the at quarterback. He can see those guys moving around over where the defense is. They'll turn around and hesitate a little bit.
Phil Wise finally tackled him. You can see what that block conversion attempt meant. And now
they're not going to go for the extra point on this play.
No. Nope.
The field goal on this play.
They have 16 seconds.
They can still go for the victory and have the time.
They have no timeouts.
With an incomplete pass, they'll have the time.
Yeah, they'll try one.
I kind of like this. They're not going to play it close. They're going to go to win this thing.
Right. Otherwise, we face the prospect of an overtime.
First and goal. said, be careful. And he was. Had a man there, but he was making absolutely sure that there would be no pickoff.
Fiery competitor, isn't he?
Yeah, he really is. I think they're going to try it again, maybe. I saw Turner head out toward the field, I mean, to the playing field, and they called him back.
How do you like this?
They could get in a little bit of trouble if Weiss got trapped back there. Getting the field goal team on the field. They have no timeouts, of course.
Put this game in perspective and think about Denver defense. All the time they spent out on that field. How they held together. Kept the club in the ball game. And then this little pepper pot, Weiss, came in and gave them the spark and life they needed.
They've got 5 seconds to get this play off. Two. They got it.
Weiss bootlegging, rolling out. Now, this is the trouble I spoke of. He cannot stop the clock. Phil Wise. They're going to lose the football game.
Oh,
they're unscrambling.
Why has the clock stopped?
There were no timeouts remaining for Denver. They'll let the teams get into position.
Well, we'll have another huddle with the officials after this.
Start the clock. 2-1. It's good. It's tied up. It's the officials' judgment as to when they pile, get rid of the pileup, get the teams back on side. It is incumbent upon the defense to get back on side.
I don't know what that happened.
Well, I would like to get into that.
Boy, and you have some unhappy
Chuck Coleman is enraged. Look at, Bud Grant's enraged. Oh. Matt Blair's enraged. Fred McNeil is enraged. And from where we
stand up here in the broadcast booth and Alan Page, you can understand it.
Well, Vikings are ready to leave. They're leaving the field. Alan Page is going to the locker room. Of course, they have a 3-minute wait. Confusion at Bloomington. Bud Grant showing emotion we haven't seen for some time.
I'm so proud of it. That's really good.
Well, I want to tell you something. Professional football, by an opinion research poll at Princeton University, is the nation's most popular sport. Now let's watch this from the preceding play, then I'll resume.
Well, number one. That's what I spoke of. He might get in trouble if he got trapped. They wouldn't have time.
Why?
They kill the clock to let the teams get lined back up. It's the referee's judgment when they start the clock. It's incumbent upon the defense to get back on sides, and then they start it. Bud Grant is saying they started way too late.
He did jump in there and stop it in a hurry.
Games have ended with, look at Fran Tarkenton, with a mix-up, an apparent mix-up on the part of the officials. The action taken in San Diego yesterday was fought by the officials in justifying the 3 consecutive fumbles that led to the touchdown, was, according to all newspaper quotes, not verified but controverted by the players themselves who made the fumbles. So now, give it to Frank for a station break. And
all right,
we'll
they
result.
Flip the coin for the kickoff. There'll be a 3-minute break. Right now, a word from our local stations.
Watch ABC News.
Of course, claiming that the clock should have been started long before that. There's the kickoff. McClanahan is deep. Minnesota having won the toss. And McClanahan hit at the 15 and moves out to the 18-yard line. Chasing the officials all over the field. And we are now looking at Tommy Kramer, number one draft pick a year ago, out of Rice University. Hands off to Foreman, right side, 4 yards.
Oh!
And it's dropped. Third down, 7. Kramer puts Robert Miller in motion. Kramer will run. And he's out of the first down at the 30-yard line, upended by Joe. Beat San Francisco in game. He beat Cincinnati.
Look out.
Whoa.
Shot goes out to the right. Sammy White is in motion. Shot left, White is right. Kramer gets Miller. Flag is down and Miller is down. Miller has the first down, but a flag is down.
And I'll bet you it's not against Minnesota.
Well, Miller is the only Viking in the area.
That was a little crossing pattern, wasn't it, where he came back out of the left side of the backfield?
All the way across. Circle of...
Illegal chuck. Defense, number 20, declined. First down.
So Kramer has come through and given them the position they want. Now,
first and 10, Minnesota. The ball at their own 49-yard line.
He's throwing
Robert Miller. Backs. Another flag is down. Latimer was in there late on Miller, and a flag. Ball at the 31-yard line. Miller in motion. Kramer. Foreman up the Kramer throws it in and it's dropped.
Actually, it keeps switching. You can't really tell.
44-yard attempt.
One looked at the flag. It was going from.
Got it. All right. Cross put it down. Landmine. Four field goals. It's over. Oh, 44-yard. He hit earlier on a 46-yard. Field goal. He had a 21-yard effort and a 25. Well, you've seen it all tonight. And some things we've never seen before.
Oh, did you see it first?
Oh, wow. Well, look at it again, and what a pressure spot.
Yes,
sudden
sir.
Death overtime, 44 yards out. And was it pretty?
Right through there, 4 for 4.
Minnesota winning it 12-9. Once again.
And those straight-on kickers are getting hard to find, too, aren't they?
Dan Meyer will never forget this moment. Once again, the final score, Minnesota 12, Denver 9. Be sure to join us this Friday night for live coverage of an exciting World Championship boxing tripleheader from the Superdome in New Orleans, Louisiana. Feature will be, of course, Muhammad Ali in his attempt for a record third heavyweight crown against the man who took that title away, Leon Spinks. Action begins at 8 Eastern, 7 Central, and 5 Pacific time. This telecast will not be seen in New Orleans or the surrounding area. Travel arrangements made through and a promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United built the largest airline here in Denver in overtime, 12-9.